fun and the flavor, the annual State Farm Bayou Classic. This was last night in here, the Battle of the Bands. A couple of Louisiana schools take their annual show on the road to Houston, hosting this holiday weekend celebration. Of course, there are strong football legacies between Grambling and Southern. The 32nd edition of this classic, a great game in 1AA. Elsewhere today.
Built by the Home Depot. Proud sponsor of college football's premier pregame show.
Oh, sometimes technology is wonderful. We appreciate the retractable roof of Reliant Stadium outside Houston today. Thunder and lightning, just a nasty day, but it will not affect the Bayou Classic as it shifts to Houston this season. Southern against Grambling. This is plan B, frankly, as we welcome you to College Game Day from Houston. Chris Fowler, Lee Corso, Kirk Herbstreit, and Desmond Howard. We had hoped to feature a lot of the bands and the fans and the flavor. Instead, it's just us in this big, beautiful place. Us and our crew. We have to give a massive 32. Very appropriate that it shifted from New Orleans to Houston, because this city really outreached to the hurricane evacuees. More than 25,000 were housed in this area after Katrina, providing shelter and support. In the Big Easy, this classic kind of had a mini Mardi Gras feel, and some of that feel certainly remains here today. But the football game has always been important. It's a one-game season, so big that both these teams give up the chance to compete for a national championship in 1AA by playing this classic. Now, Grambling dominated back in the day. Southern has won 9 of the last 11. But today, it's the Grambling Tigers who are the big favorites. They're undefeated in the SWAC. They've won games by an average of 26 points in this conference. The only loss was to Washington State. But, as with all big rivalries, guys, Southern is a dangerous underdog, and Melvin Spears knows the Jags would love to spoil his season. This whole event, though, really has so much more importance than just the football game to a lot of people.
Hey, there's no doubt about that. And like you say, it's an event. It's not just a game. And being down here for the first time, talking to people, alums, and just fans from all over the country, you realize it's like a sports culture extravaganza. I spoke to Doug Williams earlier this week, and Doug told me that this is the one game that you have to win. You can go 1-10, but if Grambling beats Southern, then you had a pretty good year. And it goes beyond just the, I want to beat my rival, and you want to have bragging rights. This game has cultural implications, but it goes back to a day when black kids couldn't go to predominantly white universities, so this was their outlet. And now you have your Harold Carmichael, your Walter Payton, who went to a historically black college, and Doug Williams. So this game has great implications for what can happen in the future, too.
Desmond, I mean, you and I talking about this yesterday, what I found really interesting and talking to some alums is this is just a big celebration, a big party, typically in New Orleans, built around Thanksgiving weekend. The game is a big deal, don't get me wrong, but it's a family reunion, a class reunion, everybody getting together from Thursday to Sunday. But Desmond's right, when it comes to the game, you can be 0-10, and if you win that one game, then make the season.
Ohio State, Michigan,
that's
Florida,
right.
Florida State,
that's
there's no difference.
Right.
You know, Grambling is nationally ranked this year, and I'll tell you, they won their last ball game 82-7, and they're going to the SWAC title game December 11th. But old Southern's got urgency and redemption going for them. Urgency, they need to win this game for a winning season, and redemption, because the G-Man beat them 24-13 last year. Now, Grambling fans are expecting a big win. Not so fast, my friends. This might be closer than the experts think.
Is that an early lean?
Absolutely.
Well, you know what that means.
Well,
leans one way.
He could give the Grambling pregame speech, though, because Melvin Spears, coach, talked to him. He is very wary of Southern. He knows the history. There are many, many upsets here. Pete Richardson, the Southern coach, has been around for 13 years at his school. So, and they have a marquee star in Grambling. Your G-men have a good quarterback in Bruce Eugene. We're going to meet him coming up. 40 touchdown passes this season for Grambling's quarterback. He also has an interesting family saga. Katrina wiped out Bruce Eugene's family home down there in New Orleans, but certainly hasn't damaged the spirit of his family, still making it a very happy
a long time.
Coming in February, Torino, then Beijing in 2008, Vancouver in 2010, and London in 2012. The Olympic legacy continues on NBC.
Welcome to the ADT Security NBC Sports Update. Here's your host, Lewis Johnson.
Reliant Stadium in Houston, one of the finest football facilities in the country. And today it plays host to the State Farm Bayou Classic as one of college football's great rivalries is renewed. Grambling State against Southern. And hello, everyone, and happy Thanksgiving. I'm Lewis Johnson, and I'll be your host throughout the day. This is the 32nd edition of the Bayou Classic, and certainly the most unusual. For the first 31 years, the game was played in New Orleans. But 3 months ago, Hurricane Katrina carved a path of devastation in the Gulf Coast region. And with the Louisiana Superdome severely damaged, the Bayou Classic looked for a temporary home. Back in September, Houston absorbed some 200,000 evacuees from Louisiana, Alabama, and Mississippi. And with the Bayou Classic looking for a place to stage its game, once again, Houston stepped in. Both Southern and Grambling State lobbied strongly for this great spectacle of black college football to continue, and through hard work and persistence, it has. More importantly, both schools have been exemplary in responding to the humanitarian crisis, donating food, money, medical supplies, and many other needed items, as well as opening up their doors to displaced students. We'll elaborate on many of these stories throughout the day, including that of Grambling State star quarterback Bruce Eugene. But right now, it's time to turn to football. So enjoy the State Farm Bayou Classic.
This has been the AD.
Reliant Stadium in Houston, Texas. The 32nd Bayou Classic. The Southern University Jaguars, 4-4 on the season, led by head coach Pete Richardson, trying to avenge last year's upset loss in this heated rivalry.
Check this out right here. Pump it, louder, come on, don't stop, and keep it going, do it. Let's get it on, move it.
Come on, baby, do it. Check this out right here.
From Reliant Stadium in Houston, Texas, NBC Sports proudly presents the 32nd State Farm Bayou Classic as Grambling State squares off against Southern. And the Tigers of Grambling State, led by head coach Melvin Spears, 8-1 on the season, 7-0 in conference play, winners of this game last year in an upset, 24-13. Everyone, glad you can join us for the 32nd annual Bayou Classic. I'm Bob Papa, along with Don McPherson and Charles Davis. So glad you can join us. A game filled with pageantry. And although the coaches and the players would like to win a conference championship for the fans, it's all about painting the victory in the Bayou Classic. And Don, when you look at this football game, Bruce Eugene is a quarterback who has rewritten the record books for Grambling State.
Yes, Bob, and Bruce Eugene is one of the best quarterbacks in college football. Coming off a season-ending injury in 2004, he is one of the best quarterbacks in all the football. He has the feet, and it all begins with great quarterbacks with the feet. He has the ability to step up in the pocket, reset his feet, and deliver a variety of passes. You'll see him here with a nice soft touch pass, but he also has, at 260 pounds, the feet to get outside and the arm strength to complete the difficult pass once he's outside the pocket. He does it all so well, and this year he has been so careful with the football. 40 touchdown passes, only 3 interceptions. He is the unquestioned leader of this Grambling State football team, and as Bruce Eugene goes, so goes Grambling.
Bruce Eugene did not play in the game last year because of a knee injury, but a medical hardship. He's back, and he's already received his degree from Grambling State. On the other side, Charles, you take a look at Southern University, and they have a quarterback who has not played in this game yet.
Yeah, and he's a mini version of Bruce Eugene. No one's as big and as strong as Bruce, but this young man, J.C. Lewis, has come on so strong for Southern University as a redshirt sophomore. His accuracy is one of his best attributes. That completion percentage goes up to 71% when they win the football game. 2,195 pass yards, that's fourth for single season records. At Southern, he has a chance to move into third place, and he makes good decisions with the football. 17 touchdowns, only four interceptions, and has taken on a lot of responsibility. Nearly 74% of the offense as a first-year starter.
One thing that you know for certain when you're talking about the Bayou Classic, throw out the record in this heated rivalry and strike up the band. It's a battle of two football teams and a battle of the bands. From Reliant Stadium in Houston, Texas, Grambling State and Southern in the 32nd Bayou Classic. Coming up next on NBC. Classic, Southern and Grambling State just getting set for the start of action in this afternoon's ballgame. And Grambling State led by head coach Melvin Spears. Last year on an interim basis, he came in and knocked off Southern University as we sent it down to Darren Horton.
Melvin Spears, an opportunity to be perfect in the SWAC. What would it mean to win this Bayou Classic?
Well, we're going to have to do a number of different things. We got to play consistent football. Certainly, we got to minimize our mistakes and just come out and play 60 minutes of Tiger football.
Best of luck to you, Bob.
Look forward to it.
Bob, let's go back up to you.
All right, thank you very much, Darren. And you see Coach Spears. He's got the sunglasses on, had some eye problems. You get a look at Coach Richardson as well, the head coach of Southern.
Now, the sunglasses are due to the eye problems that Coach Melvin Spears had a cornea transplant about 13, 14 years ago. And that's why he wears the sunglasses all the time, light sensitive, and wearing the suit to honor Eddie Robinson and a number of other greats in the coaching profession.
Albert Turner on the return for Southern. Gets it up to the 40 and finally shouldered out of bounds by Tyrone King. So Tim Manuel's kickoff return, 37 yards by the junior from Baton Rouge, Albert Turner.
You know, we talked about this game. The Bayou Classic is a lot of emotion, and a big return to start the game by Turner electrifies the Southern sideline and the Southern fans that are here. It's a great start for Southern football. They need to get off to a quick start.
Don't be surprised today with them with a 4-4 record if they try and do something exotic real early in this first series.
J.C. Lewis, the quarterback for Southern. He'll work out of a shotgun set. Five receiver formation. He's a southpaw. Over the middle to his outstanding receiver, James Vernon. J.C. Lewis, a redshirt sophomore, mechanical engineering native major. 17 touchdowns, four interceptions as we take a look at the starting lineups. Brought to you by Ford, proud sponsor of the State Farm Bayou Classic. James Vernon, an all-SWAC player last year. Again, to the passing game. That's Vernon, or Pittman, actually. He's able to pick up a couple on the play. We take a look at the offensive line. Reuben Oliver, a redshirt freshman, starts at the left tackle spot. Linda Wells, a senior. Brandon Jones, Wyatt Tatum, and Colby Green up front. Second down. Lewis will run it to Nichols, his outstanding tailback, who takes it inside the 40 to the 38-yard line of Grambling State. Take a look at the defense for the Tigers of Grambling State. Jason Hatcher, 7.5 sacks, one of the ends, with Matt Dewey, the other end, 4.5 sacks. Melvin Matthews is a freshman from Clinton, Louisiana. Dimitri Carr controls the middle with 77 tackles, along with Joshua Bester and John Carter. Greg Fassett, the key man in the secondary, three interceptions this season. Dizer and Mills have veteran experience. Third down for Lewis. Got a first down to the 25-yard line, hooking up with Gerard Landry, his 30th catch of the season.
J.C. Lewis has been consistent all year because he's matured in this offense. He knows where he wants to go with the football, and Landry is his favorite receiver on time with the football.
Gerard Landry, a big, strong, physical receiver. Look how he pushes downfield and comes underneath, secures the catch, and immediately gets upfield for additional yardage.
Nichols on the run, dragged down, and that's the middle linebacker, Dimitri Carr. A loss of two on the play, and there's an injured player on the field for Southern. And that is the quarterback, J.C. Lewis.
And I know it's a cliche, but he is the man they can ill afford to lose. Taking 99% of their snaps this year at the quarterback position.
C.J. Bird, a freshman from Marshall, Texas,
who has not thrown a pass this year. And head coach Pete Richardson upset, maybe feeling that Lewis was hit after the play.
And that's not going to be Pete Richardson's major concern. This is a team that has been decimated by attrition in a variety of ways, Charles. They've lost players to suspensions. They've lost players to academic reasons. They've lost players to injury. And this is an injury, as you said, that they can ill afford in this ballgame. He looks like he's up and breathing a little bit, but they cannot afford to have him out one play.
What happens to Southern also is that if C.J. Bird comes in, as we take a look at the replay, that's Lewis going away. We're seeing the tackle there. Lewis going away must have gotten whacked on the backside. That's just what your educated guess would tell you. When a quarterback rolls away, a lot of times the defense is taught, make sure you check the quarterback.
Well, if that's the concern,
in case of a run play.
Pete Richardson has a lot to complain about because there was no great fake. There was no illusion that he had the ball, was going out for a pass, so he should not have been touched by anyone.
In fact, we saw the ball carrier, Nichols, nearly to the ground, and we saw the quarterback, J.C. Lewis, still upright. It's a loss of two, and Lewis has to go out for a play.
Well, what happens here is that the complexion of the Southern offense changes a little bit. With C.J. Bird on the field, a true freshman, he's much more mobile than J.C. Lewis. If he throws the ball, they'll try and move him outside of the pocket in order to clear passing lanes for him.
They go with an empty set. This would be the first pass attempt of the season for C.J. Bird. Instead, he'll run. And Grambling was not fooled, right into the teeth of the defense. Jason Banks was there. Matt Dewey was there, and that man, Jason Hatcher, the senior from Jenna, Louisiana.
And I believe J.C. Lewis has trotted back onto the football field, which is good news for Southern and excellent news for all of us watching the game.
I got the wind knocked out of him.
Yeah, fortunately, he's able to get back on the field. Grambling has countered already in this game with five defensive backs versus the spread formation of Southern.
Big third and 13. Lewis, 3-for-3 passing. Has time, can't complete it to Landry. And there's Greg Fassett, the leader of the secondary for the Grambling State Tigers.
And to me, that's a sign of intelligence by the defense of Grambling as we look at Lewis in the pocket taking the hit. That's close because you're supposed to be one step after the ball is released. So he was whacked on that play. By number 95, Jason Banks. But nice intelligence by Greg Fassett breaking up the play. Why? Because Southern had completed that ball about three passes before, the same exact route.
Brett Ackley will try a 45-yard field goal, his long 41 this season, and it gets blocked right at the point of attack. And Grambling State picks it up at the 20-yard line. Ball was recovered by Joshua Bester. So Ackley has his third kick blocked this season. And they got great surge up front. Looked like Matt Dewey, the defensive end, got in and knocked it away.
And that was it. Matt Dewey just coming straight up the gut. He's right in the middle of the screen. Will get his hands up. Not a very good block. Never left his feet, which means that the ball did not get up very quick by Ackley.
Southern's first opportunity does not come through. Dewey with the blocked field goal. By Ford. Ford built for the road ahead. By the United States Marine Corps, the few, the proud, the Marines. And by State Farm, great service, great rates. That's why 40 million drivers trust State Farm. Matt Dewey coming up with the blocked 45 field goal yard attempt for Southern. And Grambling State gets their first opportunity on offense.
And you can expect that Grambling State is going to go right after. I expect them to come out very aggressive. Bruce Eugene has been very complacent, kind of taking his shots where he can get them. I expect him to go up top early in this ballgame.
Ab Kwan, the talented tailback, the lone setback. Kwan, on a first down, picks his way up for 6 yards. Tackled by David Brooks, the middle linebacker. There's Bruce Eugene, the redshirt senior graduate student from New Orleans. Outstanding season as we take a look at the starting lineup. Brought to you by Ford, the proud sponsor of the State Farm Bayou Classic. Ab Kwan, Henry Tolbert, big play capabilities. All the receivers can take it to the house. Jonathan Banks anchors that left side. He's a senior from Baton Rouge. Derek Governor, the other tackle. Great protection for Bruce Eugene this season. Second and 4. Kwan gets stuffed and dropped. Loss of a yard on the play. Keyshawn Connor on the tackle. Here's the defensive front. Lionel Howard 15 tackles. He's moved over from linebacker. Joe Sykes, the other end, 9 sacks on the season. You saw Connor, who made the tackle. The linebacker's Renee Gettridge, a converted defensive end, 28 tackles on the season. Michael Williams, a freshman at that corner with Dio Bernard and Denard Duart and Jomaine Spears, the safeties. Big 3rd and 6 for Grambling State. Eugene going to run it. Eugene, first down and more, up to the 38-yard line. Finally tripped up by Duhart, but a gain of 14 and a first down, Grambling State.
Talked about Bruce Eugene in the open, about his ability to make things happen with his feet. Now, one thing you have to remember in this opening drive, Charles, that Bruce Eugene calls his own plays. So he spreads the field out, knowing he has the ability to get the first down with his feet.
And I think we'll see a return of the quarterback run game from Grambling today. Hasn't been as much of that this season, with Bruce Eugene coming off of a knee injury from last year. I think today he lets it all out.
He'll throw on first down, looking for Tolbert, and he can't find him. Incomplete. Well, you know, Melvin Spears has him not only calling the plays, Bruce Eugene, on the opening drive, but the personnel packages, the blocking, everything. So we asked him, what happens if you have a good first drive?
It's only the first drive. That's all he gets.
But he did say, if it's going great, I'll let him keep calling it, tell the coaches to take a breather.
I'll kick back and watch it and relax. But, John, as a quarterback, you understand how important that is for a quarterback's, not just his confidence, but the leadership ability for the team to look and say, hey, our quarterback's calling this whole game. You've got to believe in that guy.
Well, there's no question. He is the leader in this team in so many ways.
2nd and 10. Got a man running free. Instead, he hits Moses Harris across midfield and knocked out at the 45-yard line. But it's a first down for Grambling State. 29th catch of the season for Harris.
When Bruce Eugene gets this kind of time to throw the football, he will pick you apart. He has a very strong arm, and he has the ability to go sideline to sideline with the football.
Now, remember we talked with Henry Tolbert, his big play weapon. He ran a seam route. No one covered him. Henry probably went back to the huddle and said, guess what, Bruce, I'm open.
Coach Henry's going to say that no matter what. But in this case, he's actually accurate. He was wide open on that play.
Colbert, number 3, slot to the bottom of your screen. Eugene feeling some pressure. There's Colbert. Can't reel it in at the 8.
So close to connecting deep on that one. 5 receivers in the pattern on that play.
And the key for Bruce Eugene in this ball game is to come out with some poise and to slow his heart rate down just a little bit. He's a little hyped. This is his first Bayou in 2 years. Overthrew that pass. The second one he's overthrown with just a hair overthrown. He brings it back in just a little bit, and he's got 6.
And that was a pattern with 3 receivers to the top of your screen, and the where he tried to connect with Henry Tolbert was from the bottom of the screen, cutting to the middle of the field. So close for Grambling, so close to a big play.
Landry Carter comes in, slot to the bottom of your screen, replacing Tolbert. 2nd and 10. Quan, big hole right side. Quan has a first down to the 35-yard line. Gain of 11 on the play for Ab Quan, who starred in this game last year with Bruce Eugene out with injury, 126 yards rushing and 3 touchdowns.
And I think that he's going to get a chance to run the football again today if Southern continues to show a 3-man defensive front. Bruce Eugene commented on that in practice yesterday.
Well, that's why we saw the first 2 plays of the ball game as running plays, because Southern's coming out with a 3-man front, so he thinks he has the run game, but he's going to have to loosen things up with the pass game.
Mays in motion. Quan again. Quan can't get to the outside. Nice little move, and then he gets dragged down and dumped.
Timing seemed all off on that play. Seemed like some people thought that there was going to be a penalty and didn't really react.
Michael Williams on the tackle. You know, going back to Bruce Eugene calling these plays, it's not just on a whim of Melvin Spears. They spent all of offseason studying film together, and because of his work in the classroom, the film room, that's why Coach Spears has confidence in this young man.
And you know, the other thing that happened was Bruce Eugene was out with an injury last year, and Brandon Landers was the starter, and Bruce Eugene, during the course of the years, found himself telling Brandon Landers exactly the same things that Melvin Spears told him when he was playing. So he sees the game from a much different perspective.
Tolbert in motion. Eugene keeps it. Little shovel pass. That's Tolbert. Oh, he shakes a couple tackles and works his way to the 20-yard line. You know, last year, Tolbert had 53 rushes. They used him as a running back and as a receiver.
And Bob and Don, that play was the counter to the previous play. Remember where he handed it inside to Abquan? Now he fakes it, cuts back inside with the shovel pass to Henry Tolbert, who countered back against the grain. Previous play went to the strong side. This time they countered back inside with the shovel pass.
Face mask. 5 yards. Incidental contact. Gets number 38 on the defense. First down.
Denard Duhart, the free safety for Southern, called for the penalty. It was Lionel Howard who finally wrapped up Tolbert and stopped his progress.
Henry Tolbert in the slot to the near side on this play. He's their big play guy and as a receiver.
First and 10 for Grambling State. Eugene with a bullet touchdown. Tigers, Clyde Edwards, his 8th touchdown catch of the season.
Eugene has shown it all. He's shown some touch throwing the ball deep, although a little overthrown, but that time he showed you a big time arm. He fires this ball in the hole, puts it right where it needs to be, nice and low, coming right at you. He's going to put this ball exactly where it needs to be, nice and low. The only guy that gets it is Tolbert.
80 yards on the drive, orchestrated by the quarterback. Does he get another drive to call?
I would think that he would. And Bob, this reminded me of someone standing next to me in the booth when he was at Syracuse, orchestrating drives right downfield. First drive of the game, Grambling jumps on top.
Tim Manuel with the extra point. Bruce Eugene with his 41st touchdown pass of the season, threading the needle to Clyde Edwards. And the Grambling State Tigers strike first. Bruce Eugene rolling with a 7-0 lead. Takes first, 7-0. You see Coach Melvin Spears. He's got a microphone on. He was gracious enough to wear one today. So is Coach Peach Richardson of Southern. Bruce Eugene throwing the touchdown pass. The coach and quarterback in sync.
You're always the last guy to go out, okay? It's your show, baby.
Edwards, the Houston native, with the touchdown catch from Bruce Eugene. 10 plays, 80 yards on the drive. That's got to be special for Clyde Edwards, playing in the Bayou Classic in Houston and getting a touchdown on the first drive. Albert Turner on the return. Across the 35 to the 37-yard line. So good field position again for the Southern Jaguars. Tackle made by Cornelius Mackey.
Pico Mackey, a transfer from Fresno State. I think that if Southern, who is 4-4 coming into this game and a decided underdog, is going to make headway today, Grambling jumping on top 7-0, if you've got anything special to fire, you got to start firing it early, because they cannot afford to get down big against this Grambling offense. And I don't mean desperation. I just mean if you go into some different packages, get them trotted out now.
Vernon slot to the top of your screen. Lewis goes the other way to the tight end, Trent Thomas, a sophomore, electrical engineering major, and he picks up about 4 on the play.
I think the thing also, for Charles, for Southern, is that they have to be patient with the football, get first downs, and keep Bruce Eugene on the sideline. It has to be a central part of their game plan.
Southern had a pretty good first drive, but had a 45-yard field goal block. Lewis again. Landry's got it. First down. Fassett on the tackle at the 47-yard line of Grambling State. Gain of 11 on the play.
Fassett, yesterday we talked to him about their best receiver. He wouldn't admit that Landry was the best receiver for Southern, but he better wake up pretty quickly because Landry's going to give him fits.
That was a big physical receiver getting inside and winning position on that pattern.
Nichols, nowhere to go, loses a yard. Dimitri Carr on the tackle along with Donald Williams. One of the reserve defensive tackles. There's Dimitri Carr, a phys ed major, a senior from Farmersville, Louisiana, comes into the game with 77 tackles, 5 sacks, having an outstanding season for the Tigers.
I think Southern wants to run it enough to try and keep Grambling honest, but that is not their forte.
Lewis just got it away. He got heavy pressure from Jason Hatcher.
Bad.
take a look at Demetri Carr and the defense of Grambling State on that first Southern possession.
Is to give different looks and give them many different things to look at, and they are playing very well with their interior guys, and that's going to be a key to keep pressure on Southern's offensive line. They've had a very difficult time protecting the quarterback all year long.
What we saw in that package, their defensive ends both creating pressure and the middle linebacker creating pressure.
Pete Richardson and the Southern University Jaguars face a third and long. They want to talk things over, trying to protect the possession, move the chains, and even up this 30-second State Farm Bayou Classic on NBC. Grambling State with the early lead in the Bayou Classic. Battle of the Bands coming up at halftime. One of the many Bayou Classic traditions is the Friday night extravaganza, which features round one of the Battle of the Bands in a fraternity sorority step competition. A little taste of what the attendees got to see last night. This look brought to you by Southwest Airlines, proud sponsor of the Southwest Airlines Battle of the Band, the sorority from Southern. Alpha Kappa with a winner, and the Kappa Alpha Psi fraternity from Grambling, winners last night. Congratulations to all.
I know my father, sitting at home in New Paltz, New York, very happy to see the Noops win the step show.
Big third and 12, Lewis dragged down by Jason Banks, but we're going to get a face mask, I believe, against Banks on the sack.
And Banks pushes right up the middle of the field on Tatum, the right guard.
It depends on the face mask calls it an automatic first down, depending on whether it's a 5 or a 15. If they got him for the 15, 15 and automatic first down, which keeps the drive alive for Southern.
Referee today is Jimmy Jones.
Defense, number 5, 15 yards, first down.
Jason Banks called for the hole, the face mask.
Look where the face mask occurs. It occurs, and right there, he actually had two, because he got one on the offensive lineman, and he also got the quarterback. Can you get a 30-yard penalty, Bob?
They only called one. Larry Nichols with the short run, picked up a couple for Southern.
Somehow he'll find a way to brag about that.
I got two. But his coaches won't be happy because it kept the drive alive.
His brother won't be happy. His brother's the starting left tackle on Grambling's offense.
He's ready to get back out there and run the Tiger stretch one more time.
Second and eight. Lewis, quick decision. Pass knocked away by Fassett, intended for Landry. And, you know, when we talked with Fassett yesterday, he said Lewis doesn't really go through a lot of reads. He's going to go with the first guy he's looking at.
And that's what they're going to try to force him to do. I mentioned earlier the different looks they're going to give him on the inside. They're going to play tough coverage on the outside, knowing that he's going to go back to that Landry well just a few too many times. They're going to start to change up the looks for him a little bit.
Third down, Lewis, middle of the field. Can't hook up with Vernon.
Now Pete Richardson has a real decision to make. He just had a field goal blocked last time out. Does he go for it on fourth down in this situation? I don't think punting is the option because he doesn't have much field to work with as a punter. If I'm him, I think about going for it even though it's fourth and eight.
And he's going to go for it.
Pete Richardson gave us that look yesterday like this is not going to be an ordinary ball game. He's going to take some chances.
Fourth and eight, Lewis overshoots Turner, who had a step on the inside.
And really nothing there at all. That play was pretty much doomed from the snap based on the coverage Grambling showed. They had a player running underneath and a player over the top. Couldn't get the ball in there.
Little pressure on Lewis, not able to connect on a fourth and eight. So Grambling State will get the ball back with a 7-0 lead in the 32nd State Farm Bayou Classic. This thrown a touchdown pass. Grambling State with a 7-0 lead in the Bayou Classic. Win a trip for two to the Caribbean. Order next year's State Farm Bayou Classic for a chance to win. Stay tuned to the broadcast and record all four codes. A different code will be displayed on the screen each quarter, and then log on to Ebony.com to play and enter. Today's Watch and Win is brought to you by Ebony Magazine, Southwest Airlines, Bickerstaff Sports and Entertainment, and NBC Sports. Bob Papa, Don McPherson, Charles Davis, Darren Horton, and Lewis Johnson. At Reliant Stadium in Houston, Texas. Grambling State went 80 yards on their first drive. Bruce Eugene. The touchdown pass to Clyde Edwards.
Grambling has it spread out with five receivers, but Southern only counters with four defensive backs. They haven't used their linebackers out in coverage.
Eugene with time. Completes it. Edwards again. The Houston native gets a block. Edwards run out at the 43-yard line of Southern.
Tough part with the attrition that Southern has had on offense and defense, obviously. They're not countering with a nickel package against five receivers. So when you see this ball caught, the nearest guy to the receiver for Southern is Renee Getridge, an outside linebacker. And that allows the Grambling receiver to take it back across. He'll get a great block inside for number three, Henry Tolbert, before Clyde Edwards runs out of bounds with a first down.
Gain of 26 on the play. Eugene in the shotgun. Five weapons. Another rifle over the middle. And he completes it to one of his younger receivers, Reginald Jackson, a sophomore from Birmingham, Alabama.
You know, yesterday, Bruce Eugene talked about taking what they give you. And we've seen this kid for the last few years play. He sometimes forces the football. Right now, he's very patient with the football, taking the little dinks on the sideline, getting the big runs. But that time, keeping his feet set and watching the full field.
Did not play last year in the Bayou, but he's 0 for 2 so far.
Yeah, his stats under 50% throwing. He's normally close to 60% as a passer. And Terrence Graves, the defensive coordinator for Southern after that last strike, has countered now with a nickel package against Grambling's spread offense.
Juan ran into his own man, and he'll lose a yard. He ran into the guard, Andre Bennett.
And that's a lot of man to run into, too. I mean, Ab Kwan is one of the strongest players on the Grambling team. But when you run into Andre Bennett at 6'6", 350, it's gonna stop your forward progress.
And then David Brooks, the middle linebacker, made sure for Southern.
Yeah, he owes Andre Bennett an assist on that play.
Second and 11. Eugene will work out of that shotgun. Looks for a running lane. Hits his own man again. And he'll lose two. Lionel Howard was there to make one of the hits, along with Joseph Selders, the defensive tackle. Selders, a redshirt freshman, mechanical engineering major, 19 years of age, 18 tackles on the season.
And this is where Grambling State has their problems. It's in the red zone. And for a team that does so much between the 35s, once they get down inside the 30, they have not been that effective. One of the reasons on that last play, they had three guys going vertical. Not a lot of options for Bruce Eugene to get rid of the ball more quickly.
Much better coverage downfield by Southern's defense.
Third and 13. Eugene with all day. Right over the middle. That's Mackey, and he his way to the 15-yard line and a first down. Chico Mackey.
And talk about Mackey being the guy with a lot of grit. He's the inside receiver on this play. Sometimes they line him up. They consider him a tight end. He's going to come from the right side of the screen. You're going to see him right here. He's going to get a little push-off right there. That little push-off, just like a basketball player on the inside, Charles gets a little push-off, comes back to the football. He's a tough runner once he has the ball in his hands.
And give a lot of credit to Grambling's offensive line. They picked up the blitz on that play. Five blocked six. That gave Eugene time to find Chico Mackey downfield.
Duhart couldn't get him down short of the sticks. Eugene will run it. Nice little move. Eugene is going to score. Wow. Nimble feet for Bruce Eugene. His third rushing touchdown of the season.
And you see the strength of Eugene, but you're also going to see a tremendous block from the left side of the screen. There's Mackey right here, right there on the left side of the screen. A big block by Mackey to spring Eugene into the end zone.
Yeah, watch Andre Bennett in the beginning, number 79. He and Derek Governor, number 71. Then the block you pointed out, quarterback. Downfield, Chico Mackey. And you mentioned his balance and his footwork right in the top of the show. Talk about Bruce Eugene, another example.
You know, you look at his size at 260, you look at his feet, and he runs like a guy more your size, more about 190, 200.
You know, he's like something out of NASA, Bob. You don't know how something that big gets launched up in the air. You know, something that big is able to move his feet and get downfield, but he gets it done.
And the big part of that play was he made the decision quickly. We talk about that in the open, is the ability to make good decisions.
He's thrown for one and run for one. Bruce Eugene in Grambling State up by 14. Grambling State, a 14-0 lead. Bruce Eugene throwing a touchdown, running for one. Time for a sneak peek as we set it down to Darren Horton.
Thank you very much, Bob. We have Bruce Eugene here to kind of take us through this play. Bruce, let's take a look at the first touchdown first, the touchdown pass on our NBC sneak peek monitor right here.
Well, I caught the defense in the cover three defense. The safety was in the middle of the field. The cones were playing all. That's why you see me look one way, pump, and I threw it low in the way, only my wide receiver can get it. Because they were in cover three and the cones were playing off and outside.
What about the second touchdown?
Well, the second touchdown, we threw the ball down the field and the defense, I saw the defense dropping back. So I called the quarterback draw. And we caught him in the right defense and my line picked it up and I ran in for the touchdown.
Two touchdowns by Bruce Eugene. Let's go back upstairs to you, Bob.
All right, thanks, Darren. And guys, you can hear just in his voice all the film study. Notice the cover three. He gives you the pump fake left, looks for the guy right. That's a guy who's really done his work.
Yeah, being able to look defenders off and go back to the intended target, that's pretty special.
And this time, a kick not returned by Turner, but Chad Harris, and nothing doing.
Looked like they were trying something special there, trying to go a little muddle huddle and figure out who had the ball.
Donald Alexander was not fooled for Grambling State.
Alexander sniffed it out.
I saw that earlier this year in New Mexico State doing that against Cal. Coming together, four guys, who has the ball, and one guy took it all the way for a touchdown.
J.C. Lewis has missed his last four passes.
Well, they've had trouble all year long with the offensive line, so they're calling plays, trying to get rid of the ball quickly. Grambling still able to get pressure on J.C. Lewis.
Nichols in the backfield with Lewis. Nichols, Landry. Oh, Landry fighting hard and finally whacked by Dewey at the 37-yard line.
Charles, you made the call. They've been having trouble protecting Lewis all year long, and they know if they can give him time, he can be accurate with the football. And here's the matchup we've been talking about, Landry on Fassett. And you see, here's a little bit of the fight that's going on between these two football teams. They're starting to come out, and this is a big drive for Southern right now. They need to protect their quarterback and get the football back in the hands of guys like Landry.
Landry, three catches for 40 yards. Lewis, drop, sack. Jason Hatcher got a hand on him and brought him down.
And this is the piece that Grambling State has been talking about. They want to keep someone in his face, give him different looks in the secondary, get him to pump fake and not get rid of the football very quickly. Then their defensive line, their linebackers can get a hand on him.
What they have at defensive end, Grambling, and Jason Hatcher and Matt Dewey are two former tight ends. So you have athleticism coming off the defensive end, defensive end edge, and getting to the quarterback.
Lewis, little slip screen, ooh. Vernon. Wow, James Vernon, nobody's getting him. Touchdown Southern. They got in the hands of their big play threat and James Vernon made Grambling State pay.
And the key to this was the protection in the middle. You're gonna see the blitz coming in up the gut. Once they do that, there's no one in the middle of the field. He gets a little patience, he gets his blocks from his lineman coming out, and there's no one in the middle of the field because they went man-to-man coverage with the blitz coming up the middle.
Yeah, a lot of times they call it a kick screen or a tunnel screen, and the patience of Vernon made the play. Watch, waits for the blockers to get out in front and set up the tunnel for him, and then he hurdles through it for the touchdown.
And Vernon told us yesterday the first time he's really been healthy all year. Ackley's extra point is good, and Southern responds on the 67-yard touchdown pass to James Vernon. His eighth touchdown grab of the year. J.C. Lewis throws his 18th strike of the season. And James Vernon with the big score to respond for Southern. The 32nd State Farm Bayou Classic. Grambling State with a 14-7 lead over Southern. 67-yard slip screen. Pete Richardson, the head coach of Southern, with the right call. And James Vernon cruises 67 yards. Don't forget, we got the Battle of the Bands coming up at halftime. Southern band warming up. And the thing about James Vernon, no one knows how fast he is because, as the Southern coaches will tell you, he's never had to run full speed. And he didn't there either.
Didn't there because he showed such great patience and vision as a runner. And what I liked about the call from David Oliver, the offensive coordinator, and Pete Richardson, is that they used Grambling's aggressiveness against them on that play.
Landry Carter on the return, fighting his way to the 29-yard line, and then just hammered there. You know, we talked to James Vernon yesterday, and he said Coach Richardson has been such an inspiration with what happened with Katrina. He said he kept us all together. We've become a brotherhood. We appreciate what we have now. Everybody's trying to get back home, but Coach has really been a leader through the adverse times. It's easy when things are going well, but he says Coach Richardson has kept this team together. You're either in or you're out.
And when you talk to Pete Richardson and you know the type of program that he runs at Southern, it's all about having young men who graduate, who get an education, and win some football games. But the first piece of that is being a family.
Quan, the tailback. Eugene will work over center. Eugene checks off underneath. That's Tim Abney, the tight end. He picks up 11 and a first down for Grambling State. Today's Watch and Win is brought to you by Ebony Magazine and Southwest Airlines. Write down the code displayed on screen each quarter, then log on to ebony.com to play and enter. No purchase necessary to play. Official rules on ebony.com. Grambling State has scored touchdowns on each of their first two possessions. Bruce Eugene has had a hand in both touchdowns. Eye set to give it to the fullback. And Reuben Mays pounds his way for 11, almost 12 yards. And another first down for Grambling State.
I think that was a credit to Bruce Eugene as a quarterback. He looks at the defense, and he counts defensive backs. And he counted six on that play from Southern. Okay, six defensive backs. Let's see how you tackle. I'm going to throw my big guy at you. And Reuben Mays blasted right through for a first down.
Yeah, you have to give Reuben Mays some credit for breaking the tackle of Brooks, the linebacker. Ran right through his arms.
Jomaine Spears finished it up. Mays in motion. And we get a whistle. There's still 1 second on the play clock, so we'll check the call from the referee. Jimmy Jones in the final minute of this first quarter. Entertaining first quarter.
Illegal substitution on the defense, number 22. That's a 5-yard penalty.
What that simply is trying to get your personnel onto the field. And Pete Richardson saying, but I don't think it was an illegal substitution. He hasn't been very happy with the officiating thus far. But I think that Southern is going between 4, 5, and 6 defensive back packages, trying to get the right guys on the field, and you have to have them on the field before Grambling breaks the huddle.
Yeah, and you have to remember that Southern has 11 new starters on defense from a year ago this time. So they are a work in progress defensively.
They used to be called the Dog Day D. Now they call themselves the Dirty 30 because they're down so much in numbers.
A free five. Quan takes the handoff. I think the left side of the offensive line moved a hair early.
Yeah, I think it's going to be, Wilson, left guard.
So they'll give the five back.
Practice now. False start. On the offense, number 68. That's a 5-yard penalty. It remains first down.
Tommy Dural, a senior who started 6 games last year for Coach Melvin Spears, called for the penalty.
My coach in college, he said, Charles, when you get 300-plus pounds moving,
can't stop it.
Can't recall it.
So now a 1st and 10, Mays in motion, Quan the tailback. Quan can't get the edge, wrestled down by Spears after the initial hit was made by Joseph Selders.
We talked about Bruce Eugene so comfortable in the offense. Guys, he's been able to just spread the ball around to everybody.
And that's been the key. If taking a good quarterback, when he takes what they give him, you'll see that there are multiple receivers catching football game, for catching the ball, because he's taking exactly what the defense is saying. He's not looking for his guy. He's looking for what the defense is giving him.
And what you do when you spread the ball around that much, you get great effort out of all of your receivers, because they understand on any given play, they may truly get a chance to catch
that's
the
right.
ball.
Clyde Edwards, the only player with two catches, including a touchdown. Well, that's the end of quarter number one. Grambling State in front of Southern, 14-7 in the 32nd annual State Farm Bayou Classic from Reliant Stadium in Houston, Texas. James Vernon with a responding touchdown will return to the State Farm Bayou Classic after these messages from your local NBC station.
And Grambling State leading Southern 14-7 as we begin the second quarter here in the State Farm Bayou Classic. Well, Eddie Robinson was the heart and soul of black college football for nearly six decades. He paced the Grambling sidelines for 57 seasons. Over 200 of his former Tigers went on to play professionally. Four are in the Hall of Fame. In 1995, Coach Robinson became the first collegiate coach to reach the seemingly unreachable 400-win plateau. He led Grambling to 17 SWAC titles and nine collegiate black titles before retiring after the 1997 Bayou Classic. What a tremendous legacy. And as you sit here in the building, you can't help but feel the love for Eddie Robinson all over from both sides of the field, guys.
Well, no question about it. Melvin Spears, the head coach at Grambling State, chance to go visit with Coach Robinson on a weekly basis and spend time with him, pick his brain a little bit as far as things that need to be done.
And paying homage to him by the wearing of the suit. You saw in all the highlights of Eddie Robinson wearing the coat and tie on the sidelines, the professional demeanor. Melvin Spears trying to honor Coach Rob by doing the same.
Eugene's hit his last six as we start the second quarter. Can't hook up with Moses Harris. Take a look at the State Farm first half, just first quarter statistics. The stats brought to you by State Farm for your insurance and financial needs. Call a neighborhood State Farm agent today. So they're not able to get any kind of ground game going. They've responded with a 67-yard touchdown pass. Penalties equal at two apiece.
Not a surprise that they're not able to run the ball, have not run it effectively very well all season, averaging around 91 yards per game total running it. I have a feeling anything that they're going to get today will be through the air.
Third and six. Eugene's pass nearly intercepted by Dio Bernard. And if he gets the pick, he's gone.
And that's a lost opportunity for Southern. They needed another nice play on defense. They got it from Dio Bernard. But oh, what it could have been. Able to step in front of Bruce Eugene's pass here. If he catches this one, he's still running for six.
Yeah, you talked about Bruce Eugene using his eye. That time he came over very late on the throw, and Bernard got the jump on the football. It also helps when you get somebody in his face time and time again.
And here's the confidence Grambling State has in their offense. They're going for it on fourth down.
It's also showing confidence in the defense, despite the touchdown they just gave up.
Fourth and six for Eugene. Whistles it, and Edwards can't reel it in. One Edwards would like to have back.
I think he got caught worrying about walking the tightrope on the sideline as he tried to haul in the pass. Worried about catching the ball and getting his feet down inbounds. Remember, in college football, you just need one. Well, I see Clyde Edwards there. See, worried about getting the foot down, but that one was just a clear drop.
With all said and done, Southern down by seven as Bruce Eugene fails to convert on a fourth down, and the Jaguars have great field position. Bruce Eugene fails to convert on a fourth and six with the lead by seven. Don?
Yeah, and Bruce Eugene comes off the field moments ago, and he's getting into the face of Moses Harris, because what he's telling him is that you have to get inside, because he didn't have the room to throw the deep out. So he wanted Moses to push it up inside of the defensive secondary, giving him more room to work on the outside.
And of course, if you ask Clyde Edwards, he'll tell you, I catch that ball every time. On a first and 10, Southern tries to get a little running game going with Nichols, but nothing doing, maybe a half yard into the teeth of the Grambling State defense. Larry Nichols, a business major, a redshirt sophomore from Houston, right here in Houston, went to Klein Forest High School. 260 yards rushing coming into this game, five touchdowns.
I asked Pete Richardson if he's shown any signs in his first year of getting hit so many times this year, and he said this kid is tough as nails. He has not winced once after being sacked 24 times on the year.
Defender got back. Lewis overshoots Turner. Saw Donald Williams come flipping across the line, but everybody just stopped and watched, and he got back.
He never made contact, so that allowed him to get back and get into his defensive spot. A lot of teams have what they call a freeze play. When a defensive lineman gets into the neutral zone, the ball's immediately snapped, quarterback kneels down, penalty is assessed, gets you an easy 5 yards. Southern didn't have it on there. Tough to do from a shotgun formation.
Another third and long for Southern. Third and 10. Lewis feels the pressure. Dragged down, slammed down by Banks. Jason Banks.
Well, here's the problem as I see it for Southern. They are not able to block the defensive ends from Grambling.
That's right.
That was Antonio Hughes, 93, who flushed J.C. Lewis before he was dragged down for the tackle by Jason Banks. The front four of Grambling, their aggressiveness was used against them in the tunnel screen that allowed for the touchdown. But you can't make a living all day long throwing that type of a screen pass against the rush.
Matt Alvarez to punt. He's had one block this season. Grambling State has already blocked a field goal. That's a high snap.
Setting up the return here.
Carter to the edge. Carter run out and thrown out at the 40-yard line by Wilkerson, and Wilkerson's going to get flagged. 30-yard punt, 14-yard return, and tack on some more.
And I'd like to see that one because I'm not sure.
I'm not sure that's a penalty.
Because I think he's being tackled going out, and it might have been a response to the Grambling bench and just the idea of how long the tackle continued.
Well,
you know, I'm not so sure, frankly, that should have drawn a flag. You see Landry Carter take it to the outside. Let's take a look here. Quarterback, what do you think?
Well, I think Wilkerson gets his head. He's got his head
up. It's right here.
So, I mean, Carter's going to fall over him. I don't think that's much of a penalty.
See, personally, I think he catches him on the sideline right there. He's taking him out.
Ah, that extra tug
there.
He gave
him that little extra tug.
You know, that border, that white border that circles the field, and this is a stadium used by the Houston Texans, that white paint is 6 feet wide. And then you have the flooring on the bench.
I think that if I'm Pete Richardson, it's another penalty that you're thinking they're calling against my team that's unnecessary. You know, he's been upset with the officiating from the word go today.
And he's definitely going to complain because it was on the Grambling sideline.
Mays in a power formation. Mays inside the 40. Dumped at the 39 as we check in with Darren Horton.
Bob, I'm with a guy who may be a bigger star on campus than many of the football players. Earl Henry, who is a Grambling State drum major. I got to ask you the question, who won the Battle of the Bands last night?
Well, honestly, it's no real winner. We have the we go by the crowd participation. If the crowd, if they cheer for us the most, then I give us the W. And if they cheer for Southern the most, I give them the W. But it was kind of even last night, so I say it was a nice show.
What do you have planned for halftime?
Well, I can't give you all my tricks. I ain't gonna lie. I can't give you all of it. But we do have this thing that we're gonna do for Katrina and Rita and the victims in New Orleans and all that. We got a little surprise for you at the end. It's gonna be a nice show, a little carnival, a carnival of fun.
Well, we are looking forward to it. Bob, let's go back up to you.
I know Charles is looking forward to giving his assessment.
No, I always enjoy the Battle of the Bands, and I've been fortunate enough to do this game for 4 years now. I've seen Southern win it, in my estimation, 4 years in a row as the halftime performance. So I'm looking for Grambling to dive back into the breach today.
I have to say, that was a humble and magnanimous little talk there by Henry.
Because normally they say, we won.
We won.
we worked it out last night, and we won.
That's right.
Mays, play fake, Eugene. Nice diving catch by Tim Abney, the tight end.
First down,
Grambling.
Bob, we talked about in the open his ability to reset his feet and make the difficult throws. And this time you're going to come and watch him come out and watch how he resets his feet and makes that throw. Lots of arm strength. He was a little bit off balance, but he got his feet underneath him. And that is a big-time throw off balance by Bruce Eugene.
Yeah. Abney with his second catch.
Joe Sykes, the best pass rusher for Southern, had a bead drawn on him, but when he was able to reset, as you mentioned, Don, and come back inside, Joe Sykes had to reset, and he wasn't able to get to the QB on that play.
First and 10, Grambling State. Quan
dragged down and dropped. Michael Williams got in on the tackle, holding it to a minimal gain. How about the offensive sets? We've seen Grambling State go five wide. Earlier in this possession, they brought Tommy Doral, an offensive lineman, in at fullback, and then they have 245-pound Reuben Mays at tailback. Now they've got Ab Kwan in, so we're getting a lot of different looks.
And that's part of the maturation of Bruce Eugene. We saw him here a couple years ago. He was a gunslinger. He was throwing the ball all over the place, scrambling out of the pocket.
Didn't matter down or distance.
Exactly right. Now they're going to a much more methodical attack. He's taking his shots. He's actually more efficient in the passing game as well.
Kwan the tailback, Mays the fullback. Kwan, nice crease up the middle, and he carries defenders near the first down marker. Joseph Selders grabbed him by the ankles, and then David Brooks jumped on. He'll be short of the first down, set up a third and short.
And part of the different offensive sets is something that people won't see. This is kind of the game that you don't get to see. Throughout the weeks of the season and in practice, Grambling has rolled through people, averaging like they're winning by like 31 points per game. So what Melvin Spears does with his offense is works on a lot of different things to keep them interested, keep them motivated in practice, and then when they need it, they're able to go to it in a game.
Eugene on the quarterback keeps, got the first down to the 10. Just went right behind the center. Tavares Cockrell, and that was easy pickings for Bruce Eugene. First down, Grambling State. They lead by 7.
And keep in mind that Grambling State has the SWAC championship game left to play. So they are going to give people a lot of things to look at and a lot of things to prepare. They also have Alcorn State
next week. Alcorn State next week at a make-up for a Hurricane Katrina game. Then the championship game in Birmingham against Alabama A&M, who they beat in the season opener 44-0. So that, you know, they've got a lot left. And don't be surprised, guys, if you see the wing T to honor Coach Rob before the day's over.
First and goal, Mays trying to shed tacklers, and great pursuit to the football by Southern. Harris Tucker, a senior from Baton Rouge, led the charge. Then he needed some help to bring down Mays.
Let's give some credit to Southern on defense. They've given up 2 touchdowns, but they have not been easy yards on this drive against Grambling. They're trying to run the ball more, but Southern, they may give up 5 or 6 on one play. The next play, they'll come back and help stuff the run. It's been a tough year all season long for Terrence Graves' crew, but they have shown no quit throughout this season.
We talk about Grambling State doing all these different things with formations and running the football, being more conservative. That's giving Southern's defense a little more confidence that the score right now is not 40-3.
Second and goal. Eugene's pass batted down at the line. Incomplete. Keyshawn Connor got his hand up and batted it away. Connor, a senior, therapeutic engineering major, 23 years of age, played at Southern Lab High School.
See the penetration inside? That's number 57, David Brooks, the linebacker, to start before the ball is batted away. Nice job, and that's what they teach you as a pass rusher. Once you can no longer get back towards the quarterback, get your hands up in the passing lane, and try and bat the ball away.
Especially down here in the red zone, you know your quarterback's not going to let guys get very deep. So if you can't get penetration right away, hands up.
Third and goal. Slip screen, incomplete. Intended for Edwards.
Frustration is indicative of Grambling State's problems inside the red zone all year long. When you have the type of offense, it's like the old run and shoot. When you have that wide spread out offense, once you get inside here with limited real estate to work with, it's hard to make your offense and your plays develop.
Because speed's negated because exactly. You have 10 yards of the end zone.
The other thing I would ask Don, as a former quarterback, if you see a hard corner, can you throw that type of a screen? Or corner?
You have to throw the fade with a hard corner.
Tim Manuel, 27-yard field goal attempt. Get set. Landry to hold. Plenty of leg. And it's good. So Manuel, now 6 of 10 on the season in field goal attempts. Tacks on 3 points. And Grambling State widens their lead to 10. Manuel, a sophomore, a weapon with the leg. This is the Bayou Classic on NBC. Bayou Classic is brought to you by Southwest Airlines. The low fare from here to there. It's not Southwest Airlines, it's southwest.com. By AARP, the power to make it better. And by State Farm, great service, great rates. That's why 40 million drivers trust State Farm. The 32nd State Farm Bayou Classic. From Reliant Stadium in Houston, Texas. Bob Papa, Don McPherson, Charles Davis, Lewis Johnson, Darren Horton. Grambling State band warming up. You'll see the Battle of the Bands at halftime here on NBC. Albert Turner back deep, awaiting the kick from Tim Manuel. Turner's nearly broken a couple.
You know, I appreciate you calling our names on air like that, Bob. I'm afraid you're going to lose oxygen after a while, considering there's all these extra announcers here for you.
Nice kick. Turner from 3 yards deep. Gets it across the 20. Chico Mackey, one of the first Grambling State players to get in there and make a hit as we check in with Lewis Johnson.
All right, Bob, you brought up the Battle of the Bands coming up at halftime. And if you ever wonder how big being in the band is in the SWAC Conference, just look at this. This is Jordan Thomas, who's 5 years of age. His mom made this outfit for him. Maybe a future drum major like Lewis Armstrong Jr., who will also be leading, Lewis Broadway Jr., excuse me, who will be leading the Southern Band on the field. Had to think about that great trumpeter. So what can we expect when you take your 128-piece band on the field?
You can expect precision, a good sound, and a good show, basically.
Precision. And just tell me, how tough is it to be a band leader like you are? How tough is the competition to get there?
It wasn't that tough for me, basically, because whenever Doc Grace is looking at me, I made sure my knees were up, and I was always focused.
And so you did everything you could to make sure you be there. All right, congratulations. And Jordan, you look sharp, buddy. Okay, back up to you.
All right, Lewis, we're looking forward to it at halftime. Southern Grambling State and the performance of the two bands. Turner, the intended receiver on the last pass play.
Will Jordan get a chance to run out there with Lewis Broadway? Do a little number? I hope so.
He'll be out there.
He's dressed for the occasion, right?
Don't forget the Battle of the Bands halftime performance. Southwest Airlines, the proud title sponsor of the Southwest Airlines Battle of the Bands. J.C. Lewis trying to battle this Grambling State defense, faces a 2nd and 10. Incomplete. A lot of traffic intended for Landry. And, you know, you can see the effects of some of those hits on the quarterback, Lewis. He's kind of moving around and feeling pressure even if it's not there.
And he never quite sets his feet to throw the football. And you can see also he's staring people down. There were 4 defenders in the area, only 1 Southern receiver. Those numbers aren't very good. Forced it in, they lucky didn't get an interception.
So now another 3rd and long for Southern, 3rd and 10. Landry at the bottom of your screen. At the 30, and again another hit on the quarterback. Marcus Binns on the coverage.
This is what it's been like for J.C. Lewis all day long. The Grambling defense getting a hit on the quarterback. Pete Richardson, the head coach of Southern, has been very unhappy about the number of hits that J.C. Lewis has taken, has felt that some of them have been late and should have drawn flags.
And all those hits were perfectly legal. And the point for Grambling State is to get in his face and let him know he's constantly there. That's why he's not setting his feet on the throws downfield.
Alvarez to punt for the 2nd time, a freshman from Bakersfield, California. Better kick this time. Landry Carter for Grambling State. Oh, Landry Carter nearly had a chance to break that one. Tripped up by Gerard Jones. Keeping it to an 11-yard return. Grambling State has put up 17 points, and they have the football here in the 2nd. Grambling State with a 17-7 lead here in the 2nd quarter of the State Farm Bayou Classic from Houston. Be sure to tune in for the Southwest Airlines Battle of the Bands halftime performance.
Stand up! 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 Stand up!
That's the Southwest Airlines, proud sponsor to be the title sponsor of the Southwest Airlines Battle of the Bands. According to Charles' account,
it's just me.
Southern has won the last 4.
I'm not sure about that,
but I think we're going to have a great one today.
Oh, it's going to be a heck of a show today. It always is.
Grambling State will start in Southern territory with a 17-7 lead. Bruce Eugene has thrown a touchdown pass and run for 1. Hit just 1 of his last 6. Eugene in a shotgun set. On 1st down, nearly intercepted and dropped through the hands of of Gregory Handy, the linebacker. And guys, what were we talking about in the commercial break? Turnovers. That's what Southern needs.
Well, that's two now that they've had a chance to get and have not come up with them. Dio Bernard, the corner before, now Greg Handy, the linebacker. Two interception possibilities don't happen.
And you see Bruce Eugene signaling over the top, over the top. He knows that was a bad throw on his part. Instead of trying to drop it in over the top, he tried to fire it in there.
Second and 10. Little screen, and that's incomplete. Looking for the tight end, Abney. He's listed as a tight end, but he's played wide receiver, so Abney is not your traditional blocking tight end.
Much more an H-back type, but I'm loving what Terrence Graves' defense for Southern is doing right now. Not the way the first one. Second one, they tried to set the screen. And on that play, David Brooks, it appeared the linebacker, was all over that one, trying to set up the screen inside to Tim Abney, the tight end slash wide receiver slash H-back.
That's right. And Southern's defense has had their backs to the wall for most of this quarter. They've played most of the quarter on this side of the field.
Third and 10 for Bruce Eugene. Can't find Abney. So Eugene has now hit on one of his last nine after the hot start.
Now, earlier in the game, we were watching how physical the Southern receivers were running their routes. On this play, Denard Duhart, the defensive back, number 38, was physical with Tim Abney, the wide receiver. Abney tried to push off. Duhart wasn't having it, stayed with the coverage, and forced the incompletion.
The playmaker is back deep to receive Tim Manuel's punt for Southern. James Vernon, averaging 14 yards a return. He has Southern's lone touchdown today.
Remember, Southern is third in the NCAA in punt returns in Division I AA, nearly 17 yards a return as a team.
Manuel's had one punt blocked this year. Gets it away quickly. Vernon with speed. Vernon across the 30 to the 33.
Bob Vernon should have never touched this football. If you're sitting here, I'm sitting here cringing. Don't catch it. Don't catch it. He's got King right in his face, but he catches the football. And then you see the speed. You talk about the speed. Look at all those yellow jerseys just going right by him as he gets up the sideline. That is an outstanding play by Vernon. But a dangerous field on the punt.
28-yard return for James Vernon. Southern looking for a score.
Hi, everyone. Lewis Johnson back in Houston. Coming up on the ADT Security NBC Sports Update, we'll bring you the Southwest Airlines Battle of the Bands. Always a great show by the marching bands of Southern and Grambling State. And we'll have the story of Grambling quarterback Bruce Eugene. He bounced back from a season-ending injury a year ago. And when Hurricane Katrina hit, he had to bounce back again.
We made a phone call to my mom, and at first she didn't want to come. She was saying that she didn't want to interfere with our college lives, you know, for myself and my brother, who's a freshman at Grambling. But we convinced her into coming, and, you know, I'm glad she's here, and I'm pretty sure she's glad that she's here.
All right, we'll bring you that story coming up at halftime. But for now, let's go back to the booth and rejoin Bob, Charles, and Doug. Guys?
Looking forward to it, Lewis. And Bruce Eugene has hit just one of his last nine passes, and a little frustration. It was pretty easy going on early. 8 of 18 in the ballgame. He's also run for a touchdown this afternoon. Well, we talked about the playmaker for Southern, James Vernon. He has the touchdown. He had the punt return. He's lined up as a running back right now in the backfield with quarterback J.C. Lewis. Lewis goes the other way and bounces it. Intended for Darwin Pittman.
Lewis took another shot from Dewey. Once again, getting in his face. Dewey's going to come from the top of your screen. He's the defensive end who, as you mentioned earlier, Charles, they have not had a chance. They have not done a great job of blocking those defensive ends.
And those defensive ends are so agile, Don. You saw Jason Hatcher, number 90. He checked James Vernon out of the backfield before he continued his pass rush to make sure he wasn't getting the football.
Vernon, slot right. Lewis, left. Landry the catch right near the sticks, and he's got a first down, gain of 11.
It's a simple game, guys. If you block the defensive ends and give J.C. Lewis an opportunity, he's very accurate. We just saw that. Both defensive ends blocked. They took care of everything inside. He had a throwing lane, and he put the football on the line to his receiver for a first down.
He had missed his previous five passes, converts there.
These defensive ends are even standing up now. I mean, they wanted to pass rush in a big way. Now you put the hand down.
Again, 7 on the play.
And that time he circled Hatcher, and he went on the inside, and what that did was opened up the throwing lane for J.C. Lewis on the outside.
And also the back, Nichols did a good job of pass protection.
Yeah, give some credit to the Southern offense now, starting to come together the last couple of drives in terms of protecting J.C. Lewis a little bit better than maybe we had seen earlier in the game.
And a good point, they just crossed the 50 for the first time this quarter.
Yeah, and they also gave him the correct spot. Nichols. No, Lewis kept it. Nice fake, and Lewis ducks inside the 45 to the 43.
That's not the best part of his game, but as we highlighted at the top of the show, nearly 74% of the offense comes from J.C. Lewis, running and passing, mainly with his arm.
Don, is it all part of the Southern strategy here? Move the ball. They got to get a score, but also bleed some clock and give their defense a chance to rest.
Absolutely. Get first downs. Keep Bruce Eugene and that offense on the sideline. And again, move the football to this side of the 50. Let's play the game on our side of the field.
Lewis intercepted. DeMichael Geiser. Into Southern territory to the 38-yard line. 30-yard return for the junior from Sterlington, Louisiana.
Well, that time, Dizer just sat on the deep route. It's an underthrown football, and Dizer undercuts Vernon. That ball needed to be put up and out.
And Luther Palmer, the defensive coordinator for Grambling, changed up. Went from zone coverage with rushing four. This time, he heats him up with a little pressure with a blitz and goes to man coverage. Zero coverage. DeMichael Dizer coming underneath. The ball needed some air. Didn't have it. Dizer takes it the other way.
And you mentioned zero coverage. There was no safety in the middle of the field, and that's why he knew he had to get the ball up and out.
First interception in 98 attempts, and here comes Bruce Eugene in Grambling State. Flags fly.
Key now for Bruce Eugene and the Grambling offense is not to show the impatience they've shown recently. I think they thought it was going to be so easy after the first two drives, they could do anything they wanted.
Final snap, false start, offense number 77. That's a 5-yard penalty, still first down.
Don, let's go back to being a quarterback. At this stage, as the leader, trying to make sure your guys stay in tune, stay in sync, instead of forcing everything and thinking it's going to be easy.
There's no question about it. They have to keep discipline, and he's running out of time on the clock here.
And you saw Bruce Eugene turn to the band and say, quiet down, please. First and 15. Can't complete it over the middle. Looking for Henry Tolbert. He actually turned back, Eugene did, to the band and said, please.
When you're calling plays from the line of scrimmage, you want to make sure that you have as much opportunity to get the signals out to your wide receivers and your linemen as possible.
Now, if I was a Southern band, I'd start playing. There he is.
Well, Southern can't, because that'd be a penalty.
That's right.
You know, it's nice if you can get away with it, right?
Eugene's hit just one of his last 10, second and 15. Frozen rope, but he overthrows Reginald Jackson.
That time, Bruce Eugene not taking his own advice and taking what they were giving him. He had the underneath route, waited for the post corner from the inside receiver, didn't have it, the secondary dropped back, fell into zone on it. He didn't have it, and he's starting to get, as you said, Charles, getting a little impatient. Things aren't happening as quickly as he wants them to.
This is an offense that's used to getting big chunks of yardage. If we look at his stats, started the game spectacularly. One for his last 11, but they're used to big chunks of yardage on each play. They're not getting them now, and they're continuing to force it downfield.
One for his last 11. He's missed his last 7. Big third and 15. Can Southern get off the field again and get a stop? And now Grambling State needs a timeout.
I don't see the same bounce in the Grambling Tigers offense as I saw earlier in the game.
Pete Richardson's team, gritty. Hanging in there, Bruce Eugene, over to Coach Melvin Spears.
You know, we talk about Bruce Eugene and him coming out with the emotion. Again, in the Bayou Classic, came out strong, throwing the ball very well, ran the ball very well for the touchdown. He was hyped at that point, but then he started to lose it just a little bit. Not keeping his eyes down the field, almost got picked, and then a second time, almost got picked. It's not necessarily that he's not thinking. I think his throws aren't very accurate right now. He's underthrowing some balls, and he's not getting his head around and his feet around. He's a little bit sloppy with some of his technique in the game, and I think that that's been the problem for him so far.
And this is the third straight possession starting in Southern territory. So far, they've only managed 3 points. Well, he's never defeated Southern, has Bruce Eugene. In his first Bayou Classic as a starter, Eugene passed for 325 yards, three touchdowns, three interceptions in a 48-24 loss. 2003, threw for 409 yards, three touchdowns, but a costly turnover in the last minute of the ballgame dampened an otherwise brilliant performance. After missing most of last season with a knee injury, he was used as a decoy in pregame warm-ups, and he watched Grambling State win from the sidelines.
Remember, Grambling ran for 279 yards in this game last year.
Third and 15, he's got it. He gets 20. And he's got Henry Tolbert.
And that time, Bruce Eugene rolling out, getting himself out of the pocket. Sometimes a quarterback needs to move a little bit with protection. So he rolls out with protection. You see he's got Abquan right out in front of him. Gets his feet set, and he waited on the route. He had one guy in mind that time, waited on the route, waited for Tolbert to come open.
Yeah, he delivered a strike, too. That looked like the Bruce Eugene we talked about in the beginning, not the one who had missed his last eight in a row.
First in the school rankings in every important category for a quarterback. He's going to run it. And he gets to the 18-yard line. You know, you see those numbers, and he didn't come in as a big-time recruit either.
Yeah, Melvin Spears, the coach, credits seeing him in the gymnasium when he was just a freshman, walked into the gym and said, look at this little fat kid playing basketball. Said, I see a lot of myself in him, wanted to give him a shot, went to Doug Williams, and Doug Williams said, this kid's not going to play here. Melvin Spears said, he's going to be the best we've ever had here.
How about that?
And he's rewritten the record books. And the two have a unique bond. They really get along on so many levels. And that's why there's the trust.
Similar personalities, and they have really meshed as quarterback and head coach.
Second and two. Eugene. A little high that time, intended for George Pigott. And he couldn't haul it in.
You talk about that relationship between player and coach, especially quarterback and head coach. These two are very similar. When you talk to them, you hear the same kind of swagger in their voice, the same kind of almost freestyle, and that's why he gets that first series, because coach wants to see if he's thinking the same way he's thinking. If Bruce Eugene is thinking the same way, once he sees that, he lets him go. And I think that was the difference between Bruce Eugene and Doug Williams. Didn't kind of see the same things the same way.
So the yard is piling up on the Grambling side.
Abquan, still on his feet. Finally knocked down at the 11-yard line. Denard Duhart on the tackle. You know, Quan was the difference maker last year in this Bayou Classic for Grambling State.
Yeah, 126 yards and three touchdowns, and I think he'll get opportunities to continue to run the ball today. Nice kick-out block there from his offensive lineman. There's Derek Governor, number 71, getting some work done. Henry Tolbert, number 3, a wide receiver downfield. And then the determined running of Ab Quan, not wanting to be knocked off his feet.
First and 10 from the 12. Quan again gets a yard, and that's it. Justin Leggett at the bottom of that pile.
We talked about Quan, the MVP last year. I like the way he runs the football. Keeps his shoulders low. We talked about the balance, strong balance, always falling forward with the football. He's a guy that doesn't get a lot of attention because he plays at Grambling State with Bruce Eugene. But when they need him, in moments like this in the ballgame, he is very effective.
DeLorean rushing also got a hand in on that tackle.
There's a double stack there. Receivers behind each other on both sides, so it's really a balanced set.
Second and 9, Pete Richardson wanted to take a look at the formation and talk to his defense. Obviously, holding Grambling State to 3 here would be huge. Well, today's Watch and Win is brought to you by Ebony Magazine and Southwest Airlines. Write down the code displayed on screen each quarter, then log on to ebony.com to play and enter. No purchase necessary to play. Official rules on ebony.com. Grambling State band warming up. They will perform at halftime. Battle of the Bands here, the 32nd Bayou Classic. Reliant Stadium in Houston, Texas. That is a joy to watch, especially from our press box position. Oh, yes. Because you see all the nice formations.
Well, this is a tremendous facility, and what a weekend for the city of Houston. Had a classic in here last night. Prairie View and Texas Southern. The Houston Texans host St. Louis Rams here tomorrow. Three straight days of football in a gorgeous facility.
Natural grass surface. We talked to Juan Rodriguez, who manages the field. They'll replace all of the field between the hashes tonight. Eugene on a second down. Sidearms it. Touchdown, Grambling State. Henry Tolbert. His 12th touchdown catch of the season. What a strike by Eugene.
I mentioned earlier the run and shoot, and this is a little bit like the old run and shoot where you have two players stacked on one side. Bruce Eugene just waiting to see what's going to happen on what the old days called run and shoot, the switch route. What's going to happen with the inside guy? He's going to go in or out. The outside guy keeps the secondary wide. The inside guy takes his pick in or out in the middle.
Two other observations as they line up for the extra point.
Tim Manuel has it blocked.
End of play. It could have turned into 2 points for Southern if they were able to pick it up and run it back.
I think it was Glenn Bell with the block.
Yeah, the things I thought about on the last touchdown for Grambling, one, the protection. Offensive line gave it to him. And then how Bruce Eugene delivered the football. Dropped down to sidearm to make sure he was able to rifle through. Look at the protection. He has time. And then look how he dropped down to sidearm to get the ball into Henry Tolbert. He took the hit at the end, but stayed in. Watch. See, right at the end, he takes the hit. But you notice his concentration downfield never left. Even as he's going to the ground, focus on Henry Tolbert. And, yeah, I'll exchange a hit for a touchdown. Look at that smile.
And the inside guy is going to be Bell on the inside, coming in underneath the protection for the block on the extra point.
That's about as clean a block as you're going to get. I mean, that one hit him right between the three and the two.
And Henry Tolbert with that 18-yard catch on the third and 15 to keep the drive alive. Then the 11-yard touchdown catch. What did Henry Tolbert say yesterday? He said, if you want to win, let three spin.
That's right. And what do they call him? The X Factor. And the X Factor came to the front for Grambling.
That kickoff goes through the back of the end zone, and Southern will start at their own 20. An interception got it all going as we set it down to Darren Horton for a sneak peek.
That's right, Bob. I'm standing here with DeMichael Deeser, who had that interception to set up that touchdown. And tell me about that play. What did you see?
You know, we did a good job taking man-to-man. We was able to get a good jump on the ball. I did a good job playing all-man technique and was able to make a break on the ball.
And when you got the ball in your hands, man, you had some jets.
Yeah, I was trying my best to get in the end zone. We're trying our best to score a defensive touchdown this game.
All right, that's DeMichael Deeser. He's got to get back on the field, guys.
It was his first interception of the season. Lewis gets it off to Darwin Pittman. And Pittman across the 25 to about the 26-yard line. Gain of 6 on the play.
Don't worry, Darren. He'll sacrifice one play to get that interview, that prime time interview right. With you.
You know, you always hear in ball games, this is an important drive. Well, this is a very important drive for Southern. With just over 3 minutes left in the half, they need to keep the ball out of Grambling State's hands. They don't want another score to go down 23. So they need to get the ball across the midfield. They need to try to get a score this drive.
And Grambling is playing exactly as you just discussed, quarterback, because they took a defensive timeout with the idea of let's shut them down.
That's
here,
right.
And get the ball back and try and get one more score. Now, these guys are stretching for their halftime performance. That is more stretching than I've done since my last college football game.
And we know how long ago that
we
was.
Know it's a long time ago.
Well, coming up at halftime, the ADT Security NBC Sports Update. It's the Southwest Airlines Battle of the Bands. Southwest Airlines proud to be the title sponsor of the Southwest Airlines Battle of the Bands.
Hey, you do have to be in shape to be in one of these bands.
We'll take a closer look at Grambling State quarterback and New Orleans native Bruce Eugene and how he and his family have overcome the devastating effects of Hurricane Katrina. Little shovel pass on the inside and just no kind of game on the ground. They try to get it this time to Vernon.
Grambling is doing such a good job with their defensive front four that they're controlling the run game with strictly four and letting the linebacker Carr just flow to the football. He's really not being touched by blockers. And then on the pass rush, they're just rushing four mainly on the last interception. They heated him up and rushed five and got a pick.
Big third down here. Lewis under pressure. Sack. Ball popped loose, but they're going to say he was down. Don't see a beanbag come out.
He emphatically, Jimmy Jones, the official, emphatically pointed to the ground three or four times. So he called him down on that play. But again, that was strictly a four-man rush by Grambling. Good coverage downfield, which allowed the front four to get to him. Looks like Jason, was that Jason Hatcher?
Jason Hatcher again.
And Charles, you hit it right on the head. They're only coming with four, but they're coming from different spots, and they're moving around a little bit, and it's giving the quarterback different things to look at, so he's not sure where to slide his protection. The other thing is when you get hit so much, you start looking for that guy.
Right.
Who's the guy that hit me the last time? Who's the guy that hit me the last three times? So you start looking for that guy, and when he's moving around, you're not looking downfield.
There you go. There goes the focus where it needs to be.
Matt Alvarez, good spiraling kick. Carter, back at his own 41. Takes one tackle, flag on the play, and then gets swarmed under. That ball came loose. Southern says they have it at the 41-yard line. That's the tug of war. Southern football. Huge play in the ball game.
Terrific. It was terrific coverage by the Southern punting unit. A great punt by Alvarez, the punter. And then look at this, Carter dancing around. There's the first guy to try and tackle him. He shakes that one, pops it there. But then the guy who started it gets back on it, and there was another Southern defender that popped it free.
Yeah, Wilkerson, I think, is the one that knocked it out. And then the birthday boy, Trent Thomas, celebrating his 20th birthday today, recovers the fumble.
See, Wilkerson, 19. Remember, Wilkerson was the guy who was one of the first tacklers.
Right.
He missed, got up, and helped make the play at the end.
Remember, Lewis was ruled down by contact, or Grambling State would have had first and 10 at the 15-yard line.
And that was a good call because he was down. The ball was down on the ground. Should not have been a fumble.
So a huge break for Southern. And Trent Thomas recovers it.
Happy birthday, Trent.
In the psychological game, Southern must come away from this with points.
Lewis. Wide open to the 18-yard line. Damian Clark tackled at the 16.
Same route as the interception. This time they were in zone coverage. He let him get past that first level and drop it in there. That time, the right pass for the right defense. Big, big confidence booster.
Damian Clark, a freshman from Houston, Texas, with a big catch. First and 10. Lewis to the end zone for Clark, and he can't reel it in.
Grambling's going to rotate defensive linemen to try and get a better pass rush.
What a thrill for Damian Clark, a freshman from Houston. Willow Ridge High School.
And you see how deep these linebackers are. That linebacker is all the way into the secondary. Lewis has to look underneath. That's where the throws are going to be right for him right now, underneath.
Second and 10, Lewis underneath. Turner had his helmet knocked off by Dizer. Give him the 9-yard line.
And another good thing that happened for Southern, they rule out of bounds and stop the clock. Because watch where the tackle takes place. Nice catch by Turner. Big time tackle coming up here. Dizer, 29. Helmet comes off. See right there? They could rule that the clock could still be in play.
Absolutely.
That was not a clear out of bounds. But instead, they ruled him out of bounds. That saved Southern some time.
And Southern can get a first down here, which can stop the clock again.
Third and four. Lewis. Vernon. But he doesn't get the sticks. Great pursuit to the football by Joshua Bester.
And Bester, number 37, guys, is an outside linebacker. But he's a former defensive back, and we saw his coverage skills on that play and his speed coming underneath and securing the tackle and forcing a fourth down.
And this is a big decision by Pete Richardson right here.
See, I don't think a field goal does him much good.
Well, I say again, in a psychological game, I think the field goal does. You come away with points, you come away with nothing, and you go into the halftime, and you go into halftime flat. You come away with points, you go into halftime thinking we can make turnovers, we can make things happen, we can get points.
Vernon didn't get far enough to get to the sticks.
Yeah, and you see the first down marker there. Vernon has to get to the first down marker. It's a long throw for the football, so he has to come back to it. Not a very wise throw for the quarterback. Needs to go someplace where he can get the ball, get receivers coming back to him once they get depth for the first down.
And really, James Vernon helped his quarterback by coming back, because otherwise that's an interception or the ball's knocked away.
Absolutely. You have to be careful down here, especially in college football with those hash marks so wide. That's a long throw to the field, and your receivers are going to have to come back to the football very often, because DBs can undercut that with so much time that ball's in the air.
Dester almost did. Now, the quarterback said you should kick it here, right? Because you want the 3 points. Southern's going to gamble and go for it.
Fourth and two.
He's got it.
Lewis hit by Dewey, but he got tackled right to the first down marker. That'll stop the clock with 45 seconds to go in the half.
Now, J.C. Lewis has to be very careful. He knows he has first down yardage. Tuck that football. Become a fullback. You'll see him make that decision. Good decision. He sees the linebackers drop deep. Now, tuck that football away and drop your head. Hang out that football. Chance that you're going to get a fumble.
Dewey's momentum actually pushed Lewis to the sticks.
And you can see how well coached they are getting up on the line. They knew the clock would stop to set the chains, but they'll whistle the ball in play, so they're saving time by being on the line.
Fourth and goal, or first and goal at the five. Lewis to the end zone, deflected away from the tight end, Brian Washington. Stops the clock with 39 seconds.
We saw the same problem with Grambling State. When you spread the offense out, you don't have a lot of options. He's trying to throw what's right in front of him. Good play by the linebacker.
They're very active, Dimitri Carr. Twice now we've seen him make plays on the football down in the red zone on this drive.
Pittman comes back in. Nichols comes in. They send Landry.
8 seconds on the play clock.
To the top of the screen. Second and goal.
Inside receivers uncovered.
Lewis to Pittman. Touchdown, Southern. They just got it off. Darwin Pittman.
Pittman was the inside receiver. He was uncovered, so the pick was natural coming from the outside.
And what I think is that what I saw was the counter to what we saw earlier in the game, where Gerard Landry is running the slant so often. Grambling jumped on the slant, and the out pattern beats him to the end zone. That's big great coaching.
Big extra point by Breck Ackley. Connects. J.C. Lewis converts a huge fourth down with his legs, and then he finds Darwin Pittman, who came into this game with no catches.
Well, Pittman's the inside receiver, and he's going to run what they call a short wheel route, which is a fake out and then up the field. The defensive back falls down. But, Charles, you mentioned it earlier. It's just a short wheel route. You see him pump fake to the inside guy, knowing that he had Pittman on the outside. And Fassett fell down, jumping on that inside route.
Pittman had no catches coming into today. 3 for 16 yards and a huge touchdown.
And I really think that touchdown was set up. All right, remember the fumble on the punt return, obviously, gave them an opportunity. The gamble on fourth down kept the drive alive. And then the touchdown afterwards came after the fake slant, getting to the outside. They set that up from earlier.
Yeah, Landry Carter trying to make a big play. Wilkerson, 19, got in there, knocked it out, and Trent Thomas recovered the fumble to set up the short field. Squibbing kick hit one of the up men. Live ball. And returned by Brian Langford to the 37-yard line. Chad Harris made the tackle.
Guys, this will be an interesting last 29 seconds, I think, because I don't imagine Grambling taking a knee and going into the locker room with a 23-14 lead.
I agree. And you see P. Richardson right there making a reaction. What he knows is he's back in the ballgame.
Yes.
His team is back in the ballgame. Jaguar Nation back in the ballgame. He wants to keep the enthusiasm and the excitement up, play on an emotional level. That's where he has the advantage.
Bruce Eugene on a first and 10. Finally feels some pressure. Nearly intercepted again. Akinwale through his hands, the freshman from Houston.
Is that three now we've counted? They should have been picked off by Southern.
Dio Bernard, Gregory Handy, and now Toyin Akinwale.
And this is why I said going into this play that this would be an interesting last 30, 29 seconds, because Grambling doesn't sit on it. And there's not a lot of time going off the clock on these pass plays. So if Southern can get a turnover, they already have momentum built. If they pick that off, how about it? Yeah, three interceptions all year for Bruce Eugene coming into today. Three near picks in this game.
Grambling State with one timeout, 22 seconds to go. Eugene.
Did he
catch
him?
By Edwards on the sidelines. They say he got a foot in at midfield.
I mean, it's hard from the naked eye. I saw him juggling going over the sideline, but he was awarded the catch. Clock stops. 16 seconds left, ball midfield. A lot of time for Grambling.
Plus a timeout.
Yes. Right.
And Charles, I think you called it right. This is an important drive because Grambling has to show that they can keep their composure and they can move the ball the way they have in the first quarter.
On first and 10. Eugene working middle of the field.
Got to get down, save time, because now it's a first down. Clock should stop.
Moses Harris with the catch. The ball to 33.
And Bruce Eugene that time, you see him patting the football. That means, that tells me one thing. He has picked out the receiver he's going to, and he's waiting for him to come clean. He wanted Moses Harris on the deep dig, which is one of Harris's favorite routes. So he was patting that football, saying, just come on open. I've got plenty of protection up front. That's what Grambling has to do, I think. I think they have to keep it simple and allow him to complete passes. Stop going with the vertical passes. Get guys coming in front of him.
All right, 7 seconds. You have a timeout. Career long for Tim Manuel, 47 yards. He's had one block this season. So what are you looking for, Don, as a quarterback here? Knowing you only have 7 seconds, you do have a timeout. Can you run that deep middle play, that deep post?
I don't think they take a chance on that. I think they go with something like a deep out with a seam up the middle. If he has the seam up the middle, he'll go with that. Otherwise, the deep out and put his kicker in better field position.
Tolbert is part of a bunch set to the top of your screen.
Up here, there's the bunch.
Landry and Tolbert and Harris. Now a flag on the play. Southern saying that it was Grambling State. They're pointing at the center, Tavares Cockrell.
Patty snap. First start. Offense, number 67, 5-yard penalty, it remains first down.
Unfortunately for Southern now, this gives them more field to have to cover.
Yeah, you actually want the field condensed versus Grambling as opposed to spread.
Entertaining first half, battle of the bands still to come at halftime. Grambling State with a 23-14 lead over Southern.
Southern with six defensive backs on the field. Looks like they've got two safeties deep. Try and cover the underneath routes with the two guys over the top.
Eugene avoids pressure, misfires. He had Piggott down the sideline. And that ends the first half. They used all seven of the remaining seconds. Bruce Eugene has thrown a couple touchdown passes, and he's run for one at halftime of the 32nd annual Bayou Classic, Grambling State. With a 23-14 lead over Southern. Stay tuned for the Southwest Battle of the Bands right after these messages and a word from your local NBC station.
Halftime of the Bayou Classic, and that means it's time for the Battle of the Bands. Southwest Airlines is proud to be the title sponsor of the Southwest Airlines Battle of the Bands. And first up, the Southern University Marching Band from Jaguarland. Under the direction of Dr. Isaac Greggs, who is retiring after 37 years at Southern, the last 24 years as their band director. Let's go down to the field.
Ladies and gentlemen, the SU band.
rock, the high step, the moving and the grooving. The Southern University Marching Band is often imitated, but never ever duplicated. When you say Southern University Marching Band, it means excitement. It is the S on their chest that lets you know that they're the best. The Southern University Marching Band is simply America's finest. So sit back, relax, for you're about to experience the most exciting time of your life. As the stimulating, the dazzling, the house rocker, the rock of all houses as the crowd pleases and takes you on a ride.
Pump it up!
Okay, we've heard the Southern University Marching Band from Jaguarland, and still to come, we'll hear from Grambling State's band, and we'll also have the story of the Tigers quarterback, Bruce Eugene. First, we step aside for these messages. Hurricane Katrina and the devastation it caused in the Gulf Coast region. Well, one story involves Grambling State quarterback Bruce Eugene. It's a story that brings together his two main loves, family and football.
Hi, I'm Bruce Eugene, quarterback, Grambling State University. This past season has probably been my best, you know, my funnest season yet. Been around, you know, so many teams here at Grambling, and, you know, the camaraderie we have around this team, you know, is just totally different from all the previous teams.
Bruce Eugene is a guy that is very, very bright and certainly is an outstanding leader on our football team, but also a guy that is a great competitor. I think that's those are the things that sets him apart from all the rest.
The Tigers leader set himself apart in 2005, enjoying an undefeated conference run to the SWAC title game, a senior season that was almost derailed from the start.
The hurricane was hitting, that probably was the most nervous time of my life. You know, I knew my mom had got out, but, well, I knew she had left early, but, you know, I wasn't sure exactly where she was.
I went to bed, woke up the next day about 12 that evening, and the news said New Orleans was gone. And it was just like, can't be. And we didn't believe it. Saw the news saw the water and everything, and it was like New Orleans was gone.
Gone was his childhood home. With family and friends needing a place to turn, the decision was made easy for Bruce by his roommate, Cameron.
It was an instant decision. I ran it by him. I said, Cam, I'm thinking about letting my mom to move. He was like, man, call him, tell him come home. She can cook, you know, and she can take my room and things of that nature.
Bruce called every day like, Ma, come up here. Ma, I got room. I felt like, okay, if I'm going to be this place, I'd rather be this place with my kids, because we're close like that.
This closeness was the foundation for the shared love of a game between a mother and a son.
A lot of people don't know it, that my mom taught me how to play football. She was the first one that, you know, that showed me how to hold my hands on the strings and throw it like this and throw it like that. I guess right now that's why we are so close-knitted, because, you know, she's really the first one to introduce me to everything. You know, she introduced me to football.
All right, go three. All right, go three. One, two, three. Four.
I'm very, very proud of Bruce Eugene and the way he's progressed in the last 4 to 5 years, not only being an outstanding football player, but the kind of character that he has and having the opportunity to step up and be the man of the family.
I do feel like a role model and a hero to some people. You know, regardless if I don't want to be, I have to be. You know, I can't run away from it, because that's the position I put myself in. Regardless of if I want to be or not, I'm a hero in people's eyes.
A role model indeed. Bruce and his roommate over the course of the past 3 months have had upwards of 13 people at a time sharing a 3-bedroom home in the town next to Grambling in Ruston, Louisiana. We'll be back with the Grambling State Band right after these messages from your local stations.
Decoration at the Festival of Trees.
Welcome back to Houston as the Battle of the Bands continues, presented by Southwest Airlines, and now the Marching Tigers of Grambling. Dr. Larry Connell is the head of Grambling State University's Marching Band Department, and they are on the field.
Field.
Thank you, Houston, for holding a classic. But we finna give all victims of Katrina. Being I'm from New Orleans, you are all New Orleanians to stand on your feet and make some noise, because we're going to be back in the double nation. It's going down, baby. Everybody get out your seat. We want everybody to do what you want to.
The State Farm Bayou Classic Committee would like to recognize and pay tribute to Dr. Isaac Griggs.
Well, look at that. You see, the Grambling Band is paying tribute to the New Orleans Superdome. Dr. Purnell, their band leader, telling us that we couldn't be at the Superdome, so we brought the Superdome to Houston. What a classy touch at the end of their performance. One of the great traditions in college football, the Southwest Airlines Battle of the Bands, and we'll be right back to Houston after these messages. Lewis Johnson back with the ADT Security NBC Sports Update. Let's get you caught up on some key scores in college football. The State Farm Bayou Classic.
A little rocky at the end of the first half.
Yeah, they really did. They started to get outside their game. They need to get back into their consistent football and start playing the way they've been playing all year long.
Charles, Southern will start on defense, but they really kind of hung tough in the first half.
They really did. They stayed the course in the first half, and it appeared they were on track to being blown out. So give Coach Pete Richardson and his staff a lot of credit for keeping these kids in the ball game. And now, remember this, they're 2-0 all time in Reliant Stadium. They're going to draw on that for the second half.
Grambling State gets the ball to start the second half. We're ready for the kickoff. Rex Ackerley will boot it away. Ackerley getting set to send it high. Instead, sends it on the ground. Bobbled, loose ball, picked up by Carter and dropped at the 17-yard line. So not a good start in the second half. Grambling State, we take a look at the State Farm halftime stats. They're brought to you by State Farm, title sponsor of today's Bayou Classic. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there. Not a lot of running for Southern, minus 3 yards. Get a look at the third downs, 1 for 7, most of them long in that first half.
What doesn't show up on the stats are the 3 near interceptions that Southern had a chance for in the first half. Could have really changed the complexion of this game.
That's exactly right. It was not a clean, crisp half for Grambling State. And they need to get back to their ball game, their way of playing. You see them come right out of the way with 4 receivers top of your screen.
Bruce Eugene's nearly had 3 balls picked off in this game, but not that time. His second touchdown of the game.
And that is Grambling football right there. They came out in the first half. Remember, they ran the ball twice?
Shujin patting that ball again. Knows he has his man. Now, real patient. Look at the block right there.
Yeah, it's Reginald Jackson, number 15. The patience that Bruce Eugene had in the pocket came from the offensive line giving him that opportunity. No real pass rush on him. Plenty of time to find a target. And a terrific block by Reginald Jackson, the sophomore, number 15.
Longest catch of his career. Second touchdown for the Houston native. Manuel with the extra point. And Grambling State on one play pushes their point total to 30.
And Charles, you mentioned having protection on the play. When you have four receivers in the field to one side of the field, you give them time to find their space, to disperse. That time, with the stretch of the field, that time all you have to do is wait to see where the defense was going to go.
And uncharacteristic of a Southern team, they didn't really fly to the ball. Denard Dewart, the safety, kind of came over and just stopped, maybe waiting for somebody else to make a play, and Edwards took that and literally ran with it.
It's almost as if they took the momentum that they generated near the end of the first half, Southern, and didn't carry it over to start the second half.
Right.
Because they had it all going their way going into the break. I thought they'd come out really fired up here in the second half. Grambling has seized the momentum back.
Right, and Grambling, you know, went into the half and said, we have to bust this thing wide open. Stop running the football. Give me the reins. I'm sure that's what Bruce Eugene was talking about.
Albert Turner on the return. Has a wall set up. Stretches it to the outside and then gets upended. Nice tackle made on the play by Brandon Logan. Turner's had a pretty good day returning kicks. A lot of pressure, though, now on Southern to have to respond offensively. They need to kind of play this game ugly and, you know, gritty, and now they got to score quickly.
That's where it becomes difficult when you play against the Tigers' stretch, a team that puts up a lot of points throughout the season when you know that you're already behind. You thought you'd start the second half, maybe get a defensive stop and start that way. Instead, it's another 7 points tacked up.
Lewis has thrown a pair of touchdown passes for Southern. Landry with the catch. Stood up at about the 33-yard line. He'll give him 8 yards on the forward progress.
See, I think if I'm Luther Palmer, the defensive coordinator for Grambling, I'm going to rush four on just about every down because they control the running game throughout. They're not worried about that. Rush my four, drop seven, occasionally blitz just for a changeup. But the reason you can do that is that you know your offense has given you a 30-14 lead, and they look like they're back on the beam.
Vernon in space. And he's able to dive close near the first down. Made a nice move on Fassett to pick up a couple extra yards.
Yeah, credit all of that to Vernon because he made a nice move on Fassett, who was right up in his face. Not a well-conceived play. He gets right up into Fassett's face right away. You see how he does that little bubble route? Well, now he's got two on one. He makes a nice move, and then a second just stiff arm, get close enough to get that first down. That was all James Vernon.
And in the stats, that was close enough to a running play. It looked like a lateral to me. It should go down as a run for Vernon, but J.C. Lewis will probably get credit for a completed pass, and that's what we've been informed.
Blitz is on. Lewis. Vernon nearly reeled it in as he took an inside route, nearly brought it home. Wilburn on the coverage.
Wilburn had no idea where that ball was. It was in the air a long time. There they are in the ISO. It was that old wheel route, the one they scored the touchdown on earlier.
See, the good thing that Wilburn had was he had inside position, so he had a pin to the sideline. When he whipped his head back inside to locate the ball, he lost it for a second. That allowed the receiver to cut back inside with a nifty little push at the hip to make a play on the ball.
Second and 10 for Southern. Lewis. Caught by Landry on Fassett.
You talked about Wilburn getting his head around. That time, Fassett does not get his head around on Landry. He thinks that Landry's running a decoy route. He's just running right alongside him and doesn't realize the ball's in the air. He's got to hear a ball call from his inside safety telling him the ball's in the air. He doesn't get his head around. And it becomes a very easy catch for Landry without any kind of resistance from the defensive back.
35-yard gain on the play. Southern in business. The plus 30 of Grambling.
What a response after Grambling State goes one play, 83 yards. to Edwards. Southern putting together a good drive here early in the third. Nichols, that didn't fake anybody, including Jason Hatcher, the end, who wrapped him up after a gain of one.
And those types of running plays, I think, are just simply trying to keep Grambling somewhat honest. You know, just enough to show you that, hey, just in case, if you're going to rush hard every time, maybe we can pop one, but it will not be their bread and butter here in the second half.
Second and nine. Lewis in traffic, nearly picked off.
Boy, he get blasted. Jason Hatcher.
Fassett nearly picked it off.
But Jason Hatcher, number 90, just came free inside. And boy, does he lower the boom on J.C. Lewis. All legal, because he got to him about the time the ball got, the ball was gone.
Right, and look who hits Fassett. That's Demetrius Carr. That tells you that the Grambling linebackers are getting way too much depth. It's time to start going underneath when your linebackers are getting more depth than defensive backs.
Lewis is taking a pounding. Third and nine. And just throws that one away. Flag, though, and we're going to get a late hit on the quarterback. And they're going to get Jason Banks of Grambling State.
Pete Richardson's been calling for that since early in the ball game, and this is the first flag that will go against Grambling for roughing the passer. Should be an automatic first down for Southern.
And that's why Pete Richardson has been on the officials the entire first half. Keep an eye on my guy. He knows that Grambling's going to come out at this young quarterback, get in his face, give him different looks, keep hitting him. Eventually, you're going to get the call, and it couldn't come at a better time.
Dead ball. Question foul on number 95 on the defense. Automatic first down.
And here he is right here. There's Hatcher coming in. He's going to just make a little spin move and then directly up and then the hit. You know what it is? He stayed up with his arms and went towards the head.
And two steps after the ball was gone.
Landry on a little screen to the receiver and he shouldered out by Carr at the 12. Minimal gain. And again, Lewis took a shot. Landry with seven catches for 103 yards.
And you remember how they started the game off, going to Landry early in the ball game. He's your possession guy. He's going to get your first downs.
Check that, 8 for 106 now for Landry.
As Alex Hankins is the trainer for Southern, J.C. Lewis will be first in line to see Mr. Hankins post-game. I mean, he's taken a lot of shots and has hung in there awfully well for a young quarterback.
Second and seven. Lewis has some room. Lewis got a block, now throws a corner to the end zone. Ruled out of bounds. Vernon didn't get his foot in. The players are pointing at the grass, looking for a divot to win their case.
I know one thing. Sidney Brown, the field judge, was all over the call. Whether he got it right or wrong, he made it definite. He was right on it and signaled immediately. Let's take a look. There's Sidney right there on the side. And I think he got it right. I mean, that's a tough one right there.
Don, you don't think that toe's in?
Let's take a look.
That's a tough call.
Let's take a look.
Ball.
There's ball.
Right toe.
See, that's, to me, that's right on the line. That's a tough one.
That's a blade of grass. That's a blade of grass.
Did the toe touch the line?
Got to go with my man, Sidney Brown. He was the one closest to it.
There's the divot.
And no instant replay in this ball game. Many fans who've watched college football this year, many of the Division 1A conferences have gone to it. Most of the 1AA conferences have not gone to replay.
Melvin Spears dodged one there. Take a look at it one more time. Right there.
What do you think?
It's really hard if you don't have the camera literally right on down the
absolutely
line. You can't really tell.
I even think from that angle, when you stop it like that, great work by our guys in the truck to stop it that closely. I think he's out.
And look at where the official is, though.
He's right on top of it.
Wow. It's close. You know what? That is so close where you have to defer to the official on the spot. That's a bang, bang look at it.
And that's so close, guys, that if replay were here today,
we'd still be talking.
What would happen is the replay official would probably say the call on the field stands because there's not enough evidence to overturn it. That's what I would think they would say upstairs.
Got to be conclusive.
Exactly. You have to show clearly that you would overturn the call.
Those officials throughout the country do a great job because they don't get a second look.
Absolutely. They don't get a chance to practice it either.
Big third and seven for Lewis. To Landry, made the catch. That's a first down. Southern, what a throw by Lewis.
Boy, this is when, as a quarterback, you know you don't want to lead your guy into the middle of the field, so you throw it to his back shoulder. It does two things. It keeps it away from the defense, but it also stops your receiver. You want to stop his momentum and bring him back to the football.
It's a great point, Don, because if he leads him into it, he leads him right into the safety, number four, Jermaine Mills, for the big hit. Throws it to the backside. He just has to contend with Bassett.
Southern with a first and goal. Lewis picks his spot. Lewis to the goal line. Where's the signal? He's in. Touchdown. So Pete Richardson, Southern Jaguars respond after giving up a one-play, 83-yard touchdown pass to start the third. They answer back.
Well, this happened because of the second and third effort of J.C. Lewis. See, he stopped, but he spins and keeps driving and falls into the end zone.
And even before that, the spread set of Southern stalemated the linebackers. They stayed back expecting the pass. They didn't come up and fill the gaps.
Extra point by Ackley is good. And J.C. Lewis, playing in his first Bayou Classic, has taken a bunch of lumps, but he has persevered, and his team hanging tight. Want a better internet? You belong at AOL. And by State Farm. Great service, great rates. That's why 40 million drivers trust State Farm. Reliant Stadium, Houston, Texas. Exciting ballgame. Grambling State leading Southern here in the third quarter. Southern responding with a huge scoring drive, and J.C. Lewis punched it in from 3 yards out. Carter on the return. Carter up to the 37-yard line. Well, Melvin Spears, the head coach of Grambling State, wanting his team to respond as we listen in.
Game, y'all got to get them back. Y'all got to get them back here now. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
They set the tempo, that little hitch to Clyde Edwards, and he went 83 yards for a touchdown.
The roughing the passer call against Jason Banks kept the drive alive for Southern. They capitalized and brought themselves right back into the game, only down 9.
Eugene shakes some pressure, then gets upended at the 41-yard line. Deal on the tackle. That's a lot coming at you.
And Grambling State came out in the same formation. You see how quickly Bruce Eugene made that decision to pull it down and run, because he had four receivers to one side, knew he didn't have much given the defense, took off and run, I think, a little bit too soon, not letting things happen. I think he's got to find that patience and find his rhythm back.
Eugene?
Yeah, I'm sorry, Bob.
Second and 5.
Get the bunch formation down below.
Carter gets the first down. Flipped up by Bernard at the 49-yard line. They'll give him a midfield.
How about how teams are able to get to basic plays
right
from different formations? Spread formation, 3-5 receivers in the pattern. It just turned into a sweep.
And what he does,
motion.
He goes into motion, and when the ball is snapped, he's in that halfback position. As we see the running back is right here, that's the halfback position that he'll stay in, or he'll be in at the snap of the football.
First and 10 for Grambling State. They've never trailed. Quan. Nice move with a hold by Quan, and finally tripped up by Bernard at the 36-yard line. Gain of 15. You know, that offensive line, they really have tremendous size and strength, and they're wearing on Southern.
I mean, they're averaging well over 300 pounds across the front. And Abquan enjoys running behind the beef of his offensive line. Just create a little bit of a crack, and he's strong enough and quick enough to get through the hole.
On a first and 10, flags fly. Jimmy Jones, our referee.
It's like a timeout being taken by Southern.
Yeah.
I know one thing. I don't know about inviting the Grambling offensive line over for dinner if I'm paying. You know? Because there goes your salary for a while. It's gone.
Well, they've been chewing up yardage, that's for certain today. Grambling State in front in the third quarter. Leading the Grambling State offense. They have a 30-21 lead, and they were talking about the size of their offensive linemen in the spring of 2005. Here are the weights of Andre Bennett, Jonathan Banks, and Bruce Eugene. They went to the Duke Medical Center where they learned about nutrition. They were there for a month. Grambling State paid for it, and as Melvin Spears told us, it wasn't just about football. This was so these young men could lead healthy lives after football as well.
Yeah, I mean, when you're talking about a life-changing move, that was it for these young guys, because at the point when you're done playing football, how are you going to live? You know, and you're supposedly getting in shape to play football. If you're 400 pounds then, you're really worried if you're not working out afterwards.
Dead ball. Captain snap. False start. On the offense. 5-yard penalty. It remains first down.
Derek Governor called for the false start. Melvin Spears also has lost weight. Calories in. Calories out.
Yeah, but he said he's got a disadvantage because as the head coach, you have to go to a lot of banquets and functions. So he gets sabotaged a little bit trying to keep his caloric intake down.
That's right. And you talked about not just, you know, being prepared for life after football, but for Bruce Eugene, life in football means he has to lose about another 20 pounds.
First and 15. Looking for the home run. Harris! Did he get in?
Bruce Eugene can tell me all about how much he likes to take what they give him and all those things, but Bruce Eugene loves to air it out. He throws the deep ball as well as you'll see anybody. He has a beautiful touch on the football and puts this ball exactly where it needs to be. Moses Harris does not give up on the route.
Great concentration by Moses Harris, because Glenn Bell, number 32, is a guy, has an arm between his arms. See that? Trying to play on the ball. Moses Harris kept his concentration, got a foot down, and wrestled the ball away from Bell for the touchdown.
And the key was he showed control before he ran out of the back of the end zone.
And we talked about the officials the last time. That time, two of them got together, made sure they had the call right. Very good job by the officials. Make sure there was possession and there were feet in bounds.
41-yard scoring strike. Coach Spears likes what he's seeing, his club in front. Back to the State Farm Bayou Classic. State Farm, like a good neighbor, State Farm is there. Grambling State with a 37-21 lead. And Coach Gray's, the defensive coordinator of Southern, not happy.
Well, you know, the one thing you never want to see your defense in a situation like that get deep. And I agree with you, Charles. I thought it was a good play defensively. But you got to know that Bruce Eugene is going to start to air this ball out. You have to protect that deep third. It was a great throw and catch by Bruce Eugene. You can't fault the defensive back in that play.
Turner on the return. Albert Turner. Just runs him out. The kicker, Tim Manuel, saved the touchdown. One more look at Bruce Eugene's 41-yard strike.
Yeah, you can get mad at the defensive back all you want, but this is just one heck of a throw and catch.
Melvin Spears responds after the touchdown signal.
That's what I'm talking about. Just got to keep working, baby. Just got to keep working. Hey, just got to keep working now. Get you some water. That's what I'm talking about. Keep working, baby. It's all right. Hey,
well, he's talking to that offensive line. Great protection so that Bruce Eugene can make these throws.
And my favorite part of that was get yourself some water. You're not done yet.
Stay hydrated. We've got a long way to go.
Lewis. Vernon. Runs out of one tackle and finally tripped up by Bins, but it's a gain of about 9.
I know that J.C. Lewis is a very intelligent young man,
And one of the reasons I know is I've seen his grades, understand his schedule, all things he's doing. But what he's also realizing is that most of the pass rushing pressure from the defensive ends is coming from wide off the edge.
Right.
So what he's doing is throwing inside those gaps. That's how he's able to throw the out route. Because normally you would throw it wider. He's stepping up inside and is still able to deliver the ball. That's a guy who's read the game and despite the hits, has learned from it.
Second and one. Herbert in the backfield. Lewis. Vernon. He's going to throw it. Coverage was there. And Dizer the closest one to it. Facet never been. Okay. With Benjamin going down the sideline.
Kind of nitpick a little bit. You remember the time they threw the ball out to Vernon wide? And they call it a pass? It's the exact same play. And now it's a lateral? You see what I mean? My point is, before they ran that same play, and they called it a pass play. Just, I know it goes into stats and all, and I like what Southern did, but which way is it? Is it a pass or is it a lateral?
Lewis on the run, Hatcher with the tackle. Did the ball go backward?
See, my contention was the first one to Vernon was a lateral. Right. And I think that this one is,
well,
too.
Here's the line right there.
See, I think it's a lateral.
I think it's back.
Yeah,
he's behind
it's
line.
It's clean. It's a clean play.
Yes.
So they could throw a second. But my contention was the first one to Vernon was a lateral, too.
Right.
Should have been a running play.
Vernon now 0 for 3 this year, passing the football. Lewis. Two defenders there, Dizer and Bins.
Yeah, and the thing was, Lewis stayed to one side. He didn't look him off. He didn't look off the safety and gave Pfizer a chance to come over the top.
Did he get hit on the play? You know, the way the ball floated up there, I was wondering if Lewis got hit. That became a jump ball between three people, two of them wearing Grambling gold.
And let's see how Lewis just stays to one side. You can get a little pump to that side.
Got a little hand on the arm, but not enough to impede Lewis getting rid of the football.
Second and 10 for Southern. Nichols back in at tailback. And what a hit that time by Wilborn. He just planted Damian Clark.
As Zaire Wilborn, number 26. Great coverage. Gerard Landry was out for a play. Watch the throw inside. See Wilborn, 26, already breaking on the football, anticipating it, and drives through the receiver, preventing it from drawing the ball into his body.
And the other thing is they've stayed on the left hash mark this entire drive, and Lewis is a lefty. He's not looking to the field, and that's where the room to throw is right now.
Third and 10, blitzes on, just gets it away, and it's intercepted again by Dizer. His second pick of the game, his second of the season. And it was the pressure that forced it.
And that's what happened when you keep hitting the quarterback, you keep hitting the quarterback. Watch him, he will not be able to step into this throw at all. He's off his feet before the ball's out of his hand, and it just floats there to the middle of the field. Great coverage on the receiver, but great job by Dizer. Playing center field.
He's the beneficiary of a pop fly there. It was the old expression, and the hits just keep on coming. That's what it's like for J.C. Lewis, because that's Joshua Bester, number 37. Earlier in the game, we saw Bester on great coverage. A former safety moved to linebacker. This time, we see him coming on the blitz and hitting the quarterback and forcing the interception.
And that's what we talked about in the first half, that pressure coming from different people in different spots. Always someone different. Don't know who to move your protection to.
And on the third and long, it almost served as a punt. False start, right side of the offensive line.
It's a good observation, Bob. In a lot of ways, maybe even better because the ball's killed inside the 10-yard line. You never want to give up a chance for points. But if you have to punt, there it is.
Dizer with a second pick of the ball game. I think Governor started early.
That ball, prior to snap. False start, number 71 on the offense. 5-yard penalty.
Big game for Bruce Eugene, especially in the second half. He's 2 for 2 for 124 yards in the second half and 2 touchdowns.
Don, did you have those kind of numbers?
That's optional football
games?
Quarterback numbers. You only get to throw the ball twice, and it's always to some big tight end.
Who no one's covering now because he's been running.
He was on the field.
62 yards of completion. Boy, if you have that in fantasy football, life's good, isn't it?
truly fantasy.
Truly fantasy football.
Well, you got a timeout on the field. And push Eugene back to the sideline. Today's Watch and Win is brought to you by Ebony Magazine and Southwest Airlines. Write down the code displayed on screen each quarter, then log on to ebony.com to play and enter. No purchase necessary to play. Official rules on ebony.com. There's the third quarter code. Well, Southern needs a three and out here. Try to hold the fort a little bit. Now, Charles, I've got to give your assessment for the Battle of Bands at the halftime. We've got a quick look at the Southern band.
Another outstanding show. Southern started so strong. Great performance. Got the tuba player out. Get his dance on one more time. But overall today, Grambling State University finishing up with the Superdome. The band, and what was the statement that Lewis said at halftime? We can't play it in the Superdome, but we can bring the Superdome to Houston. Congratulations, in my opinion, Dr. Pinnell and the Grambling State Band. You win this year's halftime show.
How many times have you been right?
It's just my opinion.
Seriously, I mean, you're like one of out of
four. What do you mean, what are you talking about? In the first 4 years, the human jukebox.
Come on. They had it going.
Grambling State runs it with Quan. He gets a couple to about the 7.5-yard line. And you see the Grambling State players, they have those gold shoes on. Bruce Eugene actually repainted his shoes for today's ball game. Sweet daddies.
Yeah, those are the covers there, the golden boots of Grambling to go with their uniform. But Bruce put a little time and effort in painting his up.
Second and 10. Quan doesn't have it, and Quan loses a couple. Gettridge at the bottom of the pile made the tackle. Maybe that was missing. He needed the gold shoes.
See, you know, if you don't follow in with the rest of the guys, things like that happen to you.
Well, this is a huge play coming up from a Southern standpoint because they have a chance to get off the field, give your offense the ball back, and pretty decent field position.
Exactly. They need this one in a big way on a 3rd-and-11 play. Terrence Graves, dog day D. They need to get the bite back in the defense on this down.
3rd-and-12 for Eugene. Feels a little pressure. Completes it up to the 18-yard line. That's Tolbert, and he's got a first down. Picks up 12.
And I immediately go back to my notes before this game. The Southern has said that we've had too many times where we've turned 2-yard gains into 15-yard gains with poor tackling. And they had Grambling stop before the first down marker, but Tolbert slips through the tackle and picks up a big first down for the Grambling State Tigers.
Quan in the backfield, Eugene to throw.
Got a man deep.
That's Harris again, and he underthrew him. And Spears defended the pass without even looking at it.
Didn't have to. He was just trying to run to catch up. And a good thing in college football, there is no face guarding penalty. So you never have to look back for the ball as long as you don't contact the receiver.
Well, he never looked back for the ball
because he was in a full sprint.
Exactly. He knew how badly he was beat deep. If that ball is put out there, it's 6 points.
Yes, exactly. You talked about Bruce Eugene patting the ball. He's patting it on that one, waiting for the big one.
Second and 10 for Grambling State. The 16-point lead here in the third. Eugene's going to run it. Eugene, look at the footwork. Bruce Eugene up to the 27-yard line. Raylan Johnson finally got him down.
You know, as quick as he is, the one thing that you can't forget is that he's 260 pounds. So you have to wrap up, and you have to almost wrap up and fall to the ground. Otherwise, not only can he run through you, he can bounce off of you.
Well, I have to ask a question here, Bob, for Don. You mentioned before, Don, about him still needing to lose 20 pounds. Why does he need to lose more weight before he goes to the pros? Maybe we'll answer this after this play.
32. Quan runs out of a tackle. Chase from behind. Nice move by Quan again, and finally tackled at the 24-yard line by Jomaine Spears. A 40-yard run for Quan.
One of the things I love about this run by Ab Quan is he is a type of runner who likes the ball inside. And so what he does is inside here, he likes to boom. He likes that contact on the inside. But then watch what happens. Once he gets into the secondary, watch him go two hands because he's expecting some guys from the outside. He knows he can't run them, so stop. Let me push him around. Let me juke him again. Smart running by Abquan. Know your style. Know what you're good at.
Donald Steele missed the tackle at the point of attack. Colbert can't haul it in at the pylon.
That was a terrific run by Abquan. Let's go back a minute, though. Why would Bruce Eugene, who seems to be nimble enough, nifty enough in the pocket, why at 260 does he need to lose more weight before the pros get a look at it?
It's all about perception. It's all about perception. The pros are going to see him. They're going to see a 260-pound guy, and they're going to say, this guy can't play in the NFL season. We're not going to take a chance on a guy that big. If he drops 20, he's down 240, even 235, if he can lose that extra 5 pounds after that, then they see him. They see, here's a guy who's committed. He's in shape. He just dropped almost 100 pounds from the right. beginning of his senior year. They'll take a bigger chance on a guy if he comes in looking the part.
Second and 10. Eugene's had all day. Another rifle. Touchdown. Clyde Edwards. Boy, the kid from Houston's having a blast today.
And I got to tell you, Chalk, if the NFL sees that throw, I don't care if he's 3'8", a man can deliver the football. He is going to put this ball on a left side of your screen, another switch route, great protection up front, and that is a beautiful throw by Bruce Eugene. That's a big-time throw. I don't care how big he is.
Exactly.
He can put the ball on a rope.
That's the kind of throw that you look at and you just say, that's as good a throw as anyone is going to make on any level.
Edwards' third touchdown catch of the ball game. Manuel hits the left upright, and that's no good. So they've had an extra point block, and now one missed. But Clyde Edwards, out of Westbury High School in Houston, Texas, a sophomore, snares his third touchdown catch of the ball game in the 32nd State Farm Bayou Classic. Edwards with his third touchdown catch of the ballgame. Grambling State with a 43-21 lead over Southern in the 30s. Along those who didn't want to be a part of what he was doing, he let them go from the football team, and they've really become a brotherhood. And talking to the players, they want so badly to win this game today so that he does not have a losing season for the first time. Eugene. Carter stopped just short of the first down. They spotted at the 35.
He had a nice tackle knocking him backwards and keeping him from the first down. It was a nice tackle by Glenn Bell, number 32.
Fourth down and a full two.
Grambling sideline divided on punting or going for it. Tim Manuel has to remember how to punt. Has had to do it at all this game.
And Coach Spears realizes the last thing you want to do is give Southern great field position right. at this point in the ball game.
Which tells you one thing. He's saying they may quit on you, but he's not sure of it
yeah,
just
he,
yet.
He has not seen them throw in the towel.
Exactly right. He is saying don't let these guys get any more life.
Manuel's had one punt block this year. They come after him, and he just gets it away.
And what a good one.
Wow. Tremendous punt. Vernon. With that unbelievable speed.
He's got the sideline.
James Vernon beats Manuel. James Vernon's going to score. No flags. 85 yards. No quit on the Southern Jaguars.
And you know what's going through Melvin Spears' mind right now? I'm a lot more comfortable with my offense on the field than I am punting the football or kicking it, because he said we've had troubles in this area during the year, and the guy he's most upset with is his punter, Manuel. Why? See that right there, that missed tackle on the sideline? I saw him really get after him coming to the sideline.
Remember, Manuel saved a touchdown on the kickoff return earlier in this quarter.
Yeah, I think Coach Spears saying, big and as strong as you are, you've got to be able to make that tackle for us.
And Bob, you called it. James Vernon does not look like he's moving very
Boy,
fast.
Is he.
But he was going by people who had the angle on the tackle.
Big extra point. Knocked through by Ackley. James Vernon. 85-yard punt return for a touchdown. Has a receiving touchdown as well.
And you just watch the guy because he breaks. He glides so well.
I'm not sure he clipped any blades of grass on this play.
And you just watch guys as the angle gets cut. It just defies everything. You know, guys know about hitting an angle on a guy when you see a certain amount of speed, but then he just goes right by him. And he went by the kicker, and I think that's the big thing for the kicker, is judging how fast he's moving based on how he looks.
Because it doesn't look like he's moving that fast. Emmanuel, who made a nice play on the kickoff return, not able to get Vernon out of bounds. And once they sealed that edge, and he took it from one side to the far side and turned the corner, that's all she wrote.
Now, you always hear about senior leadership. There's no better example of senior leadership than making big plays. That's exactly what James Vernon just did to give his team a spark.
With the kickoff. Gray on the return. Gray trying to respond. And Gray with a great return to the 41-yard line of Southern.
Well, I tell you, if I'm Melvin Spears, the first meeting that we're having before the SWAC championship game, and even the Alcorn, there's going to be a lot of special teams. A lot of special teams, because you give up the big touchdown and you come right back. You can't turn this into this type of ball game.
Inquan Gray with his longest return of the season, 54 yards, and the kicker Ackley saved the touchdown.
What? Tim Manuel unable to do it on the previous punt as the kicker back deep. This time, Breck Ackley, the kicker for Southern, saves the touchdown.
Grambling State offense back on the field. Eugene with all day. Finds Tolbert. Getrich can't bring him down. Tolbert inside the 20 and finally chased down from behind. Ricky Nevers, a defensive lineman, made the tackle, 25-yard pickup.
You know, when we talked with Melvin Spears yesterday and asked him why he wears the suit on the sidelines, he talked about honoring Coach Robinson. He talked about honoring the other great professionals. He talked about Tom Landry and Paul Brown and Bear Bryant. Well, Vince Lombardi used to wear a suit and tie on the sidelines, too. Remember him? Grab, grab, grab. Everybody's just grabbing out there. The last three plays, a lot of bad tackling because guys are grabbing rather than running through them.
Eugene, nearly intercepted. Was it intercepted by Steele? There's no signal.
Officials were not on the spot.
No, they weren't.
Yes, interception.
The best look came from the umpire.
From the umpire.
Inside,
Donald Steele gets the pick of Eugene.
And Will Lee, the umpire, had the best look. Let's see.
Off the hands of Tolbert.
It's a tough one. I think it hits the ground.
I do too.
Right there, on the ground.
It's on the ground, and he doesn't have the control. Hands are not underneath. They're on the side. But remember, once again, no replay. So they have to go with the best that they can see. He tried to ask for help. He couldn't really get it because no one else was close enough. Will Lee had to make the call.
And Southern, after dropping three easy interceptions, made the toughest one of all.
Good point, Bob. Good point.
First down for Lewis.
Man, he's got a man.
Going for it all. And he overthrows Damian Clark.
Like the call by David Oliver, the offensive coordinator. You got a little momentum going. You may be deep in your own territory, but let's take a shot at him.
You know, I know you like the call. I don't like the call. I think you have to get your team back into a rhythm. You take a shot. You got a man, no question about it. But you're taking a shot, a possibility of having to punt this ball away on Grambling State side of the football field. Your own side of the football field. You need to take the rhythm out of this, out of Grambling State right now, and get some first downs.
Clark, the freshman from Houston, Texas, goes in motion. Lewis threw a knuckleball intended for Landry.
You know, I think you make an excellent point, Don, about what they need to do. You know, let me tell you why I like the call. Because the whole game, for the most part, has been played by Grambling's defense forward. Meaning the pass rush,
right,
and everything's thrown underneath, and they respond and rally that way. They haven't been able to push them deep at all to get behind them. I thought, let's take this shot at this thing. Didn't come up. Now the problem is you're third and long.
Exactly. And keep in mind where those linebackers have been. They've been gifted 15, 20 yards deep into the secondary. Start picking them, making them play honest linebacking play at 12 yards underneath.
Lewis trying to find Nichols, and every Grambling State defender is there. John Carter, the freshman from Houston, number 47, got the initial hit on Nichols.
And this play hasn't worked all day long. I don't know why you call it here backed up, especially with the speed. We talked about
Watch
it all
Hatcher,
day long.
Number 90.
Exactly. Hatch is right here. You talk about all day long of the speed of these defensive ends, and you're not going to get him, especially if you throw the ball that quickly, you're not going to outrun him to the perimeter.
Now Alvarez has to punt. He's had one block this year. Carter standing in Southern territory. They have to get the playoff before the end of the period.
It's a low punt. That's a return ball.
Carter from his own 49.
Oh, he's going to get a block.
Wow. Gets the wall and tripped up at the 30-yard line. And I think it was Bell who got a hand on him and tripped him up. Glenn Bell. 22-yard return for Carter. That's the end of three. Grambling State in front. We'll return after these messages from your local NBC station.
At a special reading and reception.
The 34-point third quarter. Grambling State with a 43-28 lead as we start the fourth. Bob Papa, Don McPherson, Charles Davis, Lewis Johnson, and Darren Horton from Reliant Stadium in Houston, Texas. Bruce Eugene.
And he goes for it right here.
With a first and 10.
I think he goes for the end zone here.
Feels a little pressure.
Come across.
Trying to get Harris. Can't get him. We take a look at the State Farm stats through three quarters. Brought to you by State Farm. For your insurance and financial needs, call a neighborhood State Farm agent today. 384 yards in the air. 7 of 11 on third downs for Grambling State. For Southern, 3 of 12, but a majority of them have been 9 or more yards.
561 total yards for Grambling. You know, I don't think I accumulated all that in my backyard between ages 6 through 12. And I kept stats, too, man.
I know you did.
You still have it in 10. Eugene throws that one up for grabs, and he completes it to Harris. And he picks up 9 on the play.
Quarterback.
Don, let's hear that one.
All right. You know who he just reminded me of? And this is who he reminds me of a lot when he plays his game, and that's Doug Flutie. He has great vision on the field. He knows where his guys are. And he has that strength to throw that ball. Ill-advised pass. You never throw that pass. But usually when a guy does that, and he's a guy like Bruce Eugene, he makes something happen in a positive way.
Now that Raylan Johnson hanging all over him.
Now that has got to be the first ever Bruce Eugene, Doug Flutie comparison in history. And I get it.
And I
get it because of what you said.
And you've seen him play before. When he does things on his own.
Yep. I get it.
Third and one. Mays carrying Steele to the 18-yard line and a first down.
I think it's the visual for people at home. Bruce Eugene, Doug Flutie, they're going to have a hard time, but I get what you're saying by the style of play.
Exactly. From the Bayou to New England, it is the same kind
the same
of back
thing.
You mentioned the backyard. That's backyard football. When you have a guy who just loves to get out and compete, and the one thing about Bruce Eugene, Melvin Spears will tell you, he's a football junkie.
Yes.
He loves the game. He loves to compete. And when you get him outside of the system is when he's having the most fun.
Juan bouncing off tacklers and takes it all the way to the 10-yard line. Picks up almost 9 on the play.
And guys, this is a tired defense they're running against now. We talked about the attrition. We've talked about the number of guys lost. Think of the number of plays Grambling has run on offense in this game and the battle Southern's had all game long from behind, where they've had to be on the field, had to make stops, trying to make plays. I think they're very fatigued at this point. They don't have the same depth.
Yeah, and I agree with you, and I think both teams are quite fatigued, and here's where the size of Grambling's offensive line starts to take its toll.
Mays gets tripped up at the point of attack, and he'll lose a couple.
Yeah, I agree.
Deshaun Connor got in there along with Steele.
I don't care how you slice it, guys. When you've got 350, 360 leaning on you all game long, you are essentially doing a bench press on every play trying to get that off of you. Okay? So you hear about combine. Guys put 225 on the bar,
that's right,
and they bench it 42 times in a row. They'll do that, run, try and get off blocks,
that's right, and
get
when,
hit.
And when you bench it 42 times in a row, the first 30 don't really count.
No, no.
It's that last 12.
You feel those.
You feel those.
Third down for Grambling State. Eugene misfires, and it's dropped. Bell nearly had a pick six going the other way. fourth drop interception today by Southern.
And two would have been for touchdowns. This would have been the second one that would have been a touchdown. Ball's too high. Was that Abney? Tim Abney off of his hand? And once again, this is Glenn Bell's opportunity. Before, it was Dio Bernard, and Pete Richardson knows another one goes by the wayside.
Well, Pete Richardson knows that's why he's playing defensive back.
Hey, all right, now, I'm not going to try not to take that personally. What they say, defensive backs are wide receivers who can't catch?
That's all it is.
Manuel for a 30-yard field goal attempt. Snap is good. And he pushed it outside the right upright. No good. So a wasted trip for Grambling State. Pete Richardson's team now must respond here in the fourth. And Grambling State in front here in the fourth. Southern with a first and 10. Lewis. Vernon. James Vernon. A game breaker.
Ball's out.
Lost it at the 40. This is a very important tug of war right now. Looks like Southern has it. They do.
Somebody's got to step in to make that determination and point. Thank you.
I think it's Adrian Banks.
How about that?
The freshman from right here in Houston.
And what an unfortunate last 24 hours for young Adrian Banks. The offensive lineman, number 79, he's a freshman from here in Houston. His father unexpectedly passed away yesterday afternoon, but he decided to play today, saying this is his family too, and he wanted to be with them. Our sympathies to the Banks family.
Emil Bryant with the catch up to the 44-yard line. Second and six for Southern. Well, Grambling State has missed an extra point and had one blocked. That could factor in. Pittman across midfield, grabbed head high. And it's a first down for Southern. State Farm Bayou Classic brought to you by the United States Marine Corps, the few, the proud, the Marines. By Southwest Airlines, fly more, spend less with Southwest Airlines. Just visit southwest.com. And by State Farm, great service, great rates. That's why 40 million drivers trust State Farm. Southern trying to mount a comeback. First and 10, Lewis just pounded at the point of attack by Dimitri Carr, the middle linebacker.
Wow, he got high load on that one, got some help. It looked like it was Matt Dewey, number 87, underneath. No, it was number 95, Jason Banks, and Dimitri Carr, number 54. That's a training reel right there for form tackle.
And I tell you something, when your quarterback's taking so many hits in the pocket, don't put him in danger.
Second and 9, Pittman near the first down marker, shouldered out. They'll give him the spot at the 36.
The unfortunate part was J.C. Lewis is listed at 5'10", but he ran like he was 6'3", straight up. He's got to run like he's 5'2", get the pads down.
You better start running like he's 4'2".
Get those pads down. Don't take the big blows. They need you on the field, young man.
J.C. Lewis, 300 yards, 2 touchdowns, 2 interceptions. Linebacker Carr on the blitz, and he gets the sack. Back at the 45-yard line. 6th sack of the season for Dimitri Carr. Loss of 9.
And that's the tough thing. When you run away from your strength, here's Dimitri Carr right there. He's going to come in on the blitz and chase him down. And then what you have is a left-handed quarterback running to his right. He's got to get around to get rid of the football. He can't outrun Dimitri Carr. So he's stuck like Chuck, as they say. He's going down hard.
Looking for Landry, and the ball underthrown. Flag on the play. Back at midfield. In the vicinity of offensive holding. And it is against Southern.
I'm gonna play the quarterback thing here for a minute and say J.C. Lewis told his offensive lineman, hold somebody.
Please.
Please, I'm not mad at you for the hold. I'll move back if I have to throw the ball further.
Holding. 65 white, offense, that penalty is declined. Third down.
Yeah, arguably their best offensive lineman, Munda Wells, picking up the penalty, all swat.
You're surprised they declined it, because for Southern, it's probably four down territory at this point in the fourth.
Yeah, I would have pushed them back.
Third down, pass tipped at the line and incomplete. Good job by Antonio Hughes, who knocked the ball away, the senior from Birmingham.
You know, the right play, I think, would have been to take the penalty and the yardage, but Grambling wants the football. They always want the football, and they want to get through the downs as quickly as possible. Antonio Hughes with a nice rush, hands up, knocks the ball down. And the defense has played well for Grambling all year long. Well, let's not fool ourselves. What is their strength? Offense.
Offense.
What do they think when they wake up in the morning? Offense.
Colby Miller now into punt for Southern.
Now, he was the starter last year when we did this ball game.
Drills one over the head of Carter into the end zone for a touchback. 45-yard punt. But Grambling State will start at their own 20 with the lead. 28 here in the fourth quarter from Reliant Stadium in Houston, Texas. Wing T for Grambling State. Mays, the fullback. Mays up to the 30, to the 31. Lost the ball, and Southern has it. He coughed it up and recovered by the Jaguars. Handy got on it.
There's a discussion, though, with the officials about whether he was down.
Southern the ball. Another fumble by Grambling State. And Gregory Handy on the recovery.
And just when you think that Grambling continues to have this game start, you know, somewhat wrapped up, they find ways. And look at the hustle there. That was who, number 55? Sykes.
Joe Sykes forced it, and Gregory Handy recovered it.
Running it down from the backside. No quit at all. Remember Melvin Spears talking about, you know, if we score again, they'll quit. That has not happened with this Southern team.
Grambling State, two turnovers on their last three possessions. Now I get a timeout with 9:19 to go.
And Grambling took it on defense because they were not organized for the last play.
We weren't kidding when we said throw out the records when you get to the Bayou Classic. Southern trying to bounce back here in the fourth. Farm Bayou Classic. Visit a neighborhood State Farm agent today. Southern with the ball. Lewis completes it to the 10-yard line, and then a big throwdown and a flag on Dizer after Turner made the catch.
Now, that one I agree with.
Yeah, I do too.
Actually, Wilburn. He's got the throw down.
And it was the inside receiver, the post corner, short man, tall man. Now he goes, now you're out of bounds. It's the throw.
Yeah. I mean, the play was out of bounds, clearly, and he got the extra toss and throw. If that were Greco-Roman wrestling, right, that's 2 points.
Right.
But, and then in this case, it's a penalty flag.
It's 6 feet, and then another 3 feet it took him and threw him.
Dead ball. Late hit. Number 26 on the defense. After this, he's to the goal. First down.
Wilburn, who hails from right here in Houston, with the penalty.
Now watch the play action pass out of the shotgun.
First and goal at the 5. Lewis fighting toward the goal line and stood up just short. It'll be second and goal from inside the 1.
And remember this, guys, if Southern scores here with nearly 9 minutes left and kicks an extra point, they're only down 8. I mean, for the way this game has gone, it seems like more, but they're only down 8 if they score here and kick the extra point.
Grambling State had an extra point block, hit the left upright, and missed a field goal. 5 valuable points left off the board. Lewis, touchdown. Wow. What a performance by J.C. Lewis. He has taken a pounding today, but hung in there, and he gets the touchdown.
And I think you kick the extra point
right
here.
That's right.
People worried about chasing points. Make it an 8-point game. Score again, then go for 2 and try and tie it up. Otherwise, it's a 9-point game.
And exactly bangs it through. So J.C. Lewis ran it to the one, and then from inside the one, pounds it in.
You know, there's an MVP award, and then there's a courage award, and this young man gets the courage award. He gets the ball on after the penalty, calls his play twice.
Brandon Jones, the center, blocked just enough, and Coach Richardson off the turnover, fired up. His ball club is still in it. It's been an emotional day for the 13-year head coach at Southern.
It's a cheap shot on the quarterback.
Hey, how many backs they got in the game? 40? Let's go, let's go, let's go.
Oh, we got the interception.
We got that. Hey, we need a break. Can't get a break, man.
Get the ball. We got it, hey. All right.
Favorite line, gentlemen?
My favorite line. How many backs they got, 40?
Mine was, can't get a break. Oh, no, we needed a break. No, can't get a break. We got a break.
Squibbing kick returned by one of the up men, B.J. Atkins. Well, 10-2 in the Bayou Classic. He's never had a losing season in his entire career as a head coach. 109 wins at Southern. And he has that quiet, silent strength about him, leading his ball club.
And what I think people may miss, because Eddie Robinson cast such a shadow over this game, and now Melvin Spears trying to follow Doug Williams, who followed Eddie Robinson. Don't forget, Pete Richardson's following Ace Mumford.
That's right.
Who won 169 games and 5 black national titles while the head coach is Southern. So they have their legend to touch on to also, and Pete Richardson is carving his own niche himself.
First and 10, Grambling State. Juan across the 40, dragged down by Selders. Guys, another point we need to bring up here is the fact that Grambling State has been winning their games by such a huge margin. They're not in close games late. How do they respond in a tight situation?
We asked that question in practice, and I didn't really get an answer. Because the Alabama State game became close, but they were up 32-7 at one point.
That's right. And they'll tell you there are lessons to be learned, but do they actually learn those lessons?
I don't think that they've had that type of a game where it's gotten that gritty with the stakes this high thus far this year.
But if you can run it, Ab Quan will stabilize it for you all the way to the Southern 45.
And this is where your offensive line has told their coach and gestured and said, you know something? Let's earn our keep. We want to move the clock.
That's right.
We want to control the ball. I mentioned that I thought Southern's defense was tired before. Let's see if they can prove that by continuing to eat up chunks of yardage and keep the clock going. As we look at the average margin, it's almost 32 points per game for Grambling. Not today.
First and 10. Juan to the left of Eugene. Juan again. Can't find a running lane. Hit and drop. Picked up a couple. Tackle made by DeLorean Rushing.
And if you were the offensive coordinator for Grambling State right now, you have to look at what's happening. You're not getting a push from that defensive line. And so what you have to do, you look at the last four possessions, they're really not doing, I don't think they're looking at Southern. I don't think they're looking at Southern's defense and making decisions off of that. I think they're trying to control the game by their plays, but you're not getting a push by that Southern front, so they have to go back to the pass game.
Second and 8. Juan again. There's a running lane for Ab Quan. Handy drags him down at the 31, but it's a first down for Grambling State.
And Southern's going to make some changes. Three subs running right into the ball game along the defensive front to try and help them with fatigue.
Guys, no matter how much football you watch on any level, the bottom line is usually when you win, you stop the run and you can run it.
Exactly.
Yeah, that and what's the old rush theirs, protect yours in terms of the passing game.
Holbert, the motion man. Eugene. Didn't fake anyone out that time. Joe Sykes on the tackle. Loss of a yard. Well, today's Watch and Win is brought to you by Ebony Magazine and Southwest Airlines. Write down the code displayed on screen right now each quarter, and then log on to ebony.com to play and enter. No purchase necessary to play. Official rules on ebony.com. Timeout situation. Each team has one remaining. Clock moving. Under 5:40 to go.
And if you're Bruce Eugene, you're watching the play clock. Now under 10. I bleed that down to 2 or 3 seconds every time before I snap the football.
Absolutely. Second and 11. Little slip screen. Tolbert with block. Tolbert to the 14-yard line. Send it down to the Grambling sideline and Darren Horton.
Well, Bob, you remember we had talked about Bruce Eugene making all the calls offensively at the beginning of the game. Well, now Melvin Spears has turned the reins of this offense back over to his quarterback, and Bruce Eugene is making the calls on this drive. Back upstairs.
And doing a great job setting up runs. Now he's going to go for the end zone. Nearly completed to Xavier Jackson. Good coverage down there with Glenn Bell.
I know he's calling all the plays now, but quarterback, what do you think of that last call on first and 10 with the clock? Now the clock is stopped on the incompletion. You like the call?
I do like the call only because I think he thinks he earned it. Run the football, and then take the shot once you get it and go over the top. Because I think he thinks he earned that call.
And he threw it to a guy who had a 6-inch height advantage on the defensive back. Second and 10. Eugene has had all day, got hit, and that's incomplete. Hit by Lionel Howard, the end. And that is one of the few times he's been hit all day in a passing situation.
Yeah, it is.
And I think what he's upset about is that he had a hold on his inside receiver to his right side. I think that's where he wanted to go because he had the safety moved, and there was a hold call that didn't get made.
Lionel Howard, a former outside linebacker, moved to defensive end, used his speed to get to the quarterback.
Huge third down here for Grambling State, leading it by 8.
Quarterback draws, worked for them a few times in this ball game.
There it is, Bruce Eugene inside the 5, and he's got a first down to the 2. Charles, well done.
Every now and then, guy gets lucky.
Just said Brian Squirrel gets hit for every now and then.
Every so often, right? But we just adopted a blind dog from Hurricane Katrina. Named her Elsie. Elsie and I have that in common now.
11-yard run for Bruce Eugene.
That was big. The reason I thought quarterback draw is because of the running ability of Bruce Eugene. He understands protecting the football. And worst case scenario, you kick a field goal in that spot. Keep the ball in the middle of the field.
Eugene, 9 carries for 61 yards and a touchdown. Quan shut down at the 2. Good pursuit to the football by the Southern defense. Joe Sykes, the first man in.
Yeah, we talked to Anquan. We talked earlier about how he likes to go forward. That time he got himself in trouble by trying to shuffle step and go laterally. He needs to keep his shoulders down and keep pushing forward inside the 5.
You know what's strange is that that's really not a bad thing for Grambling at this stage because the clock keeps running.
Tick, tick, tick,
you know, as long as that thing's ticking for them and they can continue to hold on to the football, they're okay with that.
Well, like you said, the game clock's not what Bruce Eugene is watching. It's the play clock. And he'll bleed it right down to 2 seconds before he snaps the football.
Second and goal. Quan stood up and dropped. Wow. Justin Leggett pounded him, the junior from New Orleans.
But the clock continues to run with 3:30. Watch inside. They control the defensive front there. Plenty of help. Leggett with the big tackle. Look at that. And the celebration begins for him. But the big thing now is they can't give up any points.
No, yeah. Well, you give up a stop here. They're at extra point range, and they've already had a couple miscues there from Grambling, if you're a Southern fan.
I mean, Southern down 8. They can't afford any points given up here. They need to force some type of a turnover.
Mays, Rogers, Quan in the backfield. Play fake. Eugene trying to get to the edge. Now lobs it to Mays.
Eugene never quit on his guy, and his guy never quit on him. Mays goes down. You're going to see Mays just leak out right there. He's going to fall down, but Bruce Eugene keeps his head about him. He sees Mays get up. Nice touch on it. Lets Mays get his composure back. That is a heads-up play. Once again, Doug Flutie-like play.
Yes.
By the big man.
You know, that's one of those improvisational riffs that Bruce Eugene just went on right there. He extended the life of the play with his legs, his vision, and used his arm to complete it with Reuben Mays.
Reuben Mays with the touchdown catch. Bruce Eugene, 6 touchdown passes at the Bayou. Second Bayou Classic has produced the most total points ever. 85 in the game. Grambling State with a 50-35 lead. They squib it away from Turner. Well, the up man takes it and advances it. Chad Harris did, as we check in with Lewis Johnson.
All right, Bob, thanks a lot. Bruce Eugene here taking in some fluids. Take me back to that drive and, of course, that last touchdown. It was an unbelievable play. What happened there?
Well, the whole drive, I told Coach, put it in my hand. You know, let's get on out of here. You know, we went to the wing tee, and, you know, unfortunately, our running back fumbled. So, Coach said on that drive, look, it's yours. You know, you the man, you got this ball. Hey, you take it, you make all the calls. You know, I made some good calls, you know. They're worried about the pass not getting. Alquan, a couple of carries, he broke it. He busted a couple of big runs. I busted a big run to get it close. And, you know, on the touchdown play before, I wanted to do a bootleg. The coach like, nah, run the ball. So on third down, he told me, go ahead and run it. And I ran it. You know, I thought I was going to be able to run in, but the whole team, you know, took off the comment. They forgot about Ruben Mays in the back of the end zone.
Well, we've seen you with tears of sadness at the Bayou Classic, but you could have tears of joy. What would it mean for you to finally win this thing?
It'll be a great feeling. You know, everybody's around here talking about I got a monkey on my back and everything because I haven't won a classic. But guess what? In 2 minutes and 49 seconds, the monkey will be off. And I wonder what people have to say then.
All right, Bruce. Congrats so far. We'll see what happens in the next couple of minutes. Thanks. Back upstairs, guys.
Lewis, on the last kickoff, Grambling State was offside, so Southern will have Grambling State re-kick the football. That last drive took 5 minutes and 30 seconds. Manuel will strip it, hit by one of the up men, and recovered. Wow, that's a great job by one of the up men. Davis held on to it. Well, today's player highlights brought to you by the United States Marine Corps. The few, the proud, the Marines. Bruce Eugene, 6 touchdown passes, a touchdown run, 61 yards on the ground, and huge throws throughout the day.
I mean, and he went through a stretch where he was not connecting with receivers, started the second half, and got things going in a big way for Grambling.
There's the former head coach at Grambling State and great quarterback Doug Williams, who of course starred in the Super Bowl with the Washington Redskins, now a front office personnel man with the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Slip screen, Turner. Doesn't get much back to the original line of scrimmage.
You know what I found interesting was when Bruce Eugene talked about, they said that I have a monkey on my back because I didn't win a classic. You know who I think about with that? Two guys. One, Steve Young. Remember him saying, get the monkey off my back when he won a Super Bowl?
Right.
And Doug Williams getting the monkey off of the backs of people about black quarterbacks not being able to win. You know, he won the Super Bowl as the first black quarterback to do so. So two guys shedding monkeys, Bruce Eugene bringing it into focus.
Lewis completes it to Landry for 9 yards. Landry with his 10th catch of the ball game. That is the most by any Southern receiver this season. 10 for 125 in yardage. 3rd and 1 for Southern. Lewis is going to run it, gets the first down, and takes another beating as he takes it inside the 30. Wilburn and Mills on the tackle.
Well, I'll tell you one thing that Melvin Spears was wrong about is that these guys don't quit for Southern. You have to give them a lot of credit for the way they played in this ball game, never seemingly looking like they were out of it. They kept fighting even right down to the last series. And Bob, you said it right. That last play, that touchdown by Bruce Eugene, was indicative of the whole game. So close for Southern, yet so far.
And now an interception by Grambling State. Donald Alexander with the pick. And the celebration begins for the Tigers.
Well, J.C. Lewis has had a long afternoon, and that's a long throw to make. And he throws it, undercuts Landry. And the interception kind of seals it for Grambling, but this young man has a lot to be proud of. He fought hard all day long.
Yeah, don't hang your head, young man. Terrific day.
Today's State Farm Players of the Game from Southern. J.C. Lewis playing in his first classic. 2 touchdowns, 329 yards. And Bruce Eugene from Grambling State, 415 yards, 6 touchdowns. He also ran for a touchdown in this game. Donald Alexander celebrating his interception. Time to run the football for Grambling State. Marion Rogers on the run.
That's Dr. Isaac Griggs, the director, the man director at Southern. 24 years as the man in charge. He's retiring after this ball game. And what a terrific job he has done bringing us the human jukebox all over the United States. I'm sure he's taken them out of the country where they've been to 6 Super Bowls, 4 Sugar Bowls. And, you know, anyone who saw the movie Drumline, a lot of it was inspired by Dr. Griggs and the human jukebox of Southern University.
And the band got him a cruise on the Caribbean. He's getting the... get on a boat with his wife and take and a little cruise into retirement.
I think we understand the Grambling Band awarded that cruise to Dr. Griggs and his wife. Talk about mutual respect. Congratulations, Dr. Griggs, for the magnificent career.
You know, for a lot of people who are seeing the Bayou for the first time or who wondered if it got moved out of New Orleans, would the pageantry be there? Would it be the same game? When you see Dr. Isaac Griggs and you see Doug Williams on the sideline, you realize that the state of Louisiana has a home and a lot of support from the people here in Houston, and you see the great people who've been around. Doug Williams and Coach Rob, who I know is watching at home, they've had so much support over the years from such two great football programs and two great academic institutions.
Rogers fighting near a first down marker, and both coaches talked about how Houston has rolled out the red carpet for the two schools. Bruce Eugene, what a way to get his first win in the Classic. 0-2 didn't play last year. Huge numbers. He's rewritten the record books. You see the despair on the side of Southern.
Because remember, this is the end of Southern season. Season racked by Hurricane Katrina and Rita. Only 9 games played. This will end it for them. Grambling, 2 games left to go. Alcorn next week and the SWAC championship against Alabama A&M in Birmingham the week after.
3rd and 1. First down picked up by Bruce Eugene.
I asked Pete Richardson, has he ever had a season like this one? It's just been such a difficult time with all the problems that they've had, both on and off the field. You mentioned the hurricanes, so many different things going on for them. And for them to play the way they did this afternoon, to fight down to the wire, a lot of credit goes off. Of course, Grambling's going to get to celebrate, but Southern has a lot to be proud of in this football game.
What a difference a year makes, huh, guys? You remember last year coming into this game, Melvin Spears was not assured of returning as the head coach at Grambling. But he won the Bayou Classic, received a long-term contract, and has won his 2nd straight Bayou Classic.
Coach Spears does not get the bath. Grambling State has won the 32nd State Farm Bayou Classic. 50-35, the final score. Guys, final thoughts.
I just thought it was a terrific classic. Good luck to Grambling in the SWAC championship game.
And unfortunately, Pete Richardson, first losing season, but a great effort by the Southern Jaguars.
Grambling State wins it 50-35. Coming up next on NBC, except on the West Coast, your local news at 8 o'clock, 7 Central. It's the most outrageous TV moments, followed by Julia Roberts and Richard Gere in Runaway Bride for Lewis Johnson, Darren Horton, Charles Davis, and Don McPherson. Bob Papa saying so long from the State Farm Bayou Classic.